Russia. So for those who join us now, it's about 118 participants. Okay. For your information, this is we try to accommodate the time zone difference between Malaysia and Russia. So we in Malaysia, now it's 1 o'clock. Okay, after evening. So we are really try our best to accommodate these two country time zone difference. Okay. Before I begin, I would like to share just like to say just now the link of the e-booklet that for our participants. Maybe you'd like to know our tentative for today and tomorrow, and all the topics, all the plenary topics are very interesting. And second, before we begin, probably I would like to share a few housekeeping. Even though we still in the so-called like transition, or certain country they are in the endemic already, like Malaysia, we just starting our endemic month for this month. Hopefully, this not the first and last of first symposium, right? So just for simple housekeeping from me and our team, technical team. First of all, for the speaker, maybe if you have any problem to share your screen later, our technical team and also I or my team will share the slide for you. And then number two, for all participants, kindly mute your mic if you have any problem. Later, just type in the chat box or unmute your mic to ask any question to our team. Third, I would like to mention here very clearly, our plenary is very compact. It's about 30 minutes per session. If we have time at the end of the session, we will have a question and answer. However, if participants have a question and we don't have time to respond during the plenary, we would like to share. We will request the speaker to share their email so the participant can ask the direct question to their speaker via email. Is it okay? Because if not, later on we will have a drag all the time. And then, as we all know, our Muslim friend are in the fasting month today. So hopefully, we can finish on time for them to prepare for breakfast later. Okay. Then I would like to also mention here. Today, our first symposium, we will have so many list of all the invited speaker, all the distinguished important person in Malaysia as well as Russia. So hopefully, we will have this smooth running well of our virtual symposium. Okay. So Dr. Saiful, can we start?
Yeah, we can start. Yeah.
Thank you. So before we start, actually, we preparing a combination of all our national atoms from Malaysia as well as Russia, and we also like to introduce our university, UNIMAS, this is University of Malaysia Sarawak. Okay, so I will share my screen of the video. Thank you. Before I share the our national anthem, probably I would like to introduce and also give a brief of the objective of this symposium to all the participants. So as you as I shared the link of the ebook just now, so basically I would like to emphasize this our first anatomy and allied health sciences for this year 2022. So basically, I'd like to share the difference between Russia and Malaysia medical curriculum. However, I believe the difference not only about the traditional or integrated curriculum. However, we will learn together in this symposium how we will have the final or ultimate the best medical education for this current situation, especially during this pandemic and also as endemic. For those participants who joined us, okay, our objective for this symposium basically to update on the knowledge among the medical academicians regarding medical education in Malaysia and Russia, and as well as to strengthen collaboration and networking between UNIMAS and other universities in Malaysia and Russia. So hopefully, after today and tomorrow, we're not only ending this symposium by having end of the symposium only. However, we have we will have more collaboration between Malaysia and Russia to improve our medical education in both countries. Thank you. Sorry, I will share again the national anthem because I have the audio problem just now.
Thank you.
To all participants, as you all know, inside the e-booklet also, this is maybe the introduction for our symposium. In the year 2021, UNIMAS signed agreements with the two medical universities of the Russian Federation, a memorandum of agreement, which is MOA, with the Astrakhan State Medical University, and a memorandum of understanding, which is MOU, with the Volgograd State Medical University. These agreements stipulated students and lecturers exchange between the parties of the agreement, cooperation in research, as well as it being more than 250 years old, with Nobel laureates in medicine, Ivan Pavlov, medicine and physiology, and Ilya Mechnikov in medicine and immunology, with several world-renowned medical doctors making a tremendous contribution to clinical medicine, Nikolai Pirogov in surgery, Sergei Botkin in internal diseases, Vladimir Filatov in ophthalmology. In spite being quite young, medical education in Malaysia is developing very fast, demonstrating excellence in teaching and learning, as evidenced by the high ranking of the Malaysian universities in the international ranking system, such as QS of University of Malaysia is in the first 100, while our USM, University of Science Malaysia, and University Kebangsaan Clinical Medical Training with PPL as its key point. Volgograd State and Medical University and Astrakhan State Medical University are practicing traditional, vertically integrated version of medical curriculum and have a great interest, yet acquainted with the latest achievements of UNIMAS curriculum development. Volgograd Medical University is in the top 5 Russian universities and is widely known for its development of for personification of medical education. Astrakhan State Medical University is a leader in undergraduate students' research and conduct of different Olympiads and practical skills competitions among the medical students. All the parties of the aforesaid agreements are eager to share experience in their advanced areas and benefit from the best experiences of their partners. Malaysian, Russian Anatomical and Allied Health Sciences Symposium is the first event which is believed to be a trigger of the future interaction and collaboration beneficial for every party. So, for today, maybe I would like to just share the tentative for today. Basically, our welcome speech from our academic and international Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. Amahata bin Rashid from our UNIMAS, University of Malaysia Sarawak, followed by the welcome speech by Excellency Neil M. Latipov, the Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Russian Federation of Malaysia. And then after that, we will have our welcome speech by Associate Professor Dr. Vladimir Shakirin, Chancellor of the Volgograd State Medical University. And finally, we also have our welcome speech by Professor Dr. Olga Bashkina, Director of the Astrakhan State Medical University. So after this speech, okay, we will have our short photo group. So hopefully for those participants can stand by around 2:15 Malaysian time to open their video. If they can use their background, if they can use our background of anatomy, Malaysian Russian health sciences, so they can use our background. And then we follow the plenary 1 until 4. Okay, for plenary number 1, we have our Associate Professor Dr. William from UNIMAS. He will share the topic entitled PBL in Malaysian Medical Schools, followed by our Prof. Marina Kapitonova from UNIMAS also. She will share with us regarding updates on the preclinical medical training in Russian and Malaysian universities. We have our invited Dr. Yasro Izzat bin Abu Bakar, he from University Sultan Zainal Abidin from Peninsula Malaysia. We will share the topic entitled Effective Strategies in Teaching and Learning of Surface Anatomy. Finally, we also have our Professor Dr. Larissa Udokina, Associate Professor Dr. Matif Dizno from Astrakhan State Medical University Russia, to share with us role of students' Olympiads in undergraduate medical education. Finally, we also have Professor Dr. Sergei Porosky from Volgograd State Medical University Russia to share on personification of undergraduate medical education in the Volgograd State Medical University. Okay, hopefully we will end our first day symposium around 4:55 p.m. of Malaysian time. Okay. for tomorrow, we also I will have second day of event, which is on the 20 April 2022. We will also will start around 1:15 arrival of participants join our VBAT. Tomorrow we will have another about continue our plenary start around 1:30 p.m. of Malaysia time. Okay, we will have Dr. Numan Yaman from University of Malaysia, UKM. He will share integrated medical curriculum in Malaysian universities, and then followed by Dr. Siti Nurhani from University of Sains Malaysia, USM, on the future direction of anatomy education in Malaysia. Around 2:30 o'clock, we have our professor, Dr. Yuri Vazili. He will share on 3D technologies in anatomy, teaching and learning. Okay. And then we also have our associate professor, Dr. Akush Nazarian. She will share on Pirogov anatomical table in anatomy, teaching and learning. We also have Dr. Angela Skinner, our UNIMAS lecturer. We will share on undergraduate medical student research projects at UNIMAS. Finally, our second day of symposium, we will have our assistant professor Dr. Daniel Lipov from Volgograd American University from Russia. He will share on role of students research in undergraduate medical education in Russia. Before we end our tomorrow's symposium, we will have our dean, Faculty of Medicine Health Sciences UNIMAS, Professor Dr. Asri Bin Said, to close our symposium. Okay. So maybe I would like to say thank you very much to our special invited guests, okay, from Malaysia as well as Russia, for their time and as well as their commitment, even though they are very busy with their daily job scope in their profession. However, we were really delightful for their willingness to accept our invitation as well as to join us in this first Malaysian-Russian symposium for today and tomorrow. For simple housekeeping, for all the participants, the speaker will share their presentation. If you have any question at the end of the plenary, they will have open the question and answer session. However, if they just finish their plenary session at 30 minutes of presentation, so we will request from the speaker to share their email. So hopefully the participant can directly email to the speaker for further clarification on the respective question. Thank you very much for the nice national anthem for Malaysia, Russia, as well as our University of Malaysia song. First of all, I must say welcome to our Vice Chancellor of Professor Amar Hatarafi for joining us this afternoon. So before I let my Deputy Vice Chancellor to give his welcoming speech, I would like to read his CV to share to all our speakers as well as our participants from Malaysia as well as Russia. Professor Dr. Amar Hatta bin Rashid, he is a Deputy Vice Chancellor, Academic and International of University of Malaysia Sarawak. At present, he is also a Professor of Orthopedic at the Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences, UNIMAS, and Consultant Orthopedic Surgeon at Sarawak General Hospital. He obtained his Master of Surgery, which is Orthopedic, 2001 from University Kebangsaan Malaysia, UKM, Doctor of Medicine 1994 from University Kebangsaan Malaysia and Bachelor of Medical Science in 1991 from University Kebangsaan Malaysia. His area of expertise are clinical medicine, orthopedic limb reconstructive surgery, as well as pediatric orthopedic surgery and wound healing. We from first Malaysia Russia Anatomy and Allied Health Sciences, we'd like to have very grateful to have you in our conversation today. So now I'll share. I would like to welcome Professor Mata to share his welcoming speech. Thank you.
Okay, so can everybody hear me? Yeah.
Yes, Prof.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sajrina, for that wonderful introduction of myself. First of all, I think my respect to His Excellency Naif M. Latifov, Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Russian Federation to Malaysia. Associate Professor Dr. Valdimir Shakarins, the Chancellor of the Volgograd State Medical University, Dr. Olga Baskina, Director of the Astrakhan State Medical University, invited a speaker from Malaysian Medical School and Russian Medical School, Yang Berusaha Professor Dr. Astri Ben Said, the Deans of Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences, Deans, Directors, Senior Officer of UNIMAS, as well in the Medical School in Russian Federation, is joining us today. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to all Malaysian colleagues. Now we are at the, two o'clock here, and very good morning to our partner in Russia. At the moment, I think it's early morning, but 8:30 in Russia. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for this Anatomy and Health Sciences Symposium for inviting me to be with you all today and to officiate the opening ceremony of this Anatomy and Health Sciences Symposium, in which I was organized for the first time by UNIMAS as well and in Malaysia with the two cooperation between medical school in Malaysia as well as I think Russian Federations. I would like to congratulate for the organizer for successfully organizing this symposium. This symposium is an extension to the memorandum of agreement signed between UNIMAS and Astrakhan State Medical University and Volgograd State Medical University. This symposium is very important in exposing the lecturers and the students toward the medical curriculum, specifically anatomy subject, as well as introductions to the academician regarding the implementation of medical course in both countries. Probably in terms of implementation, this is slightly different, and this symposium will become a platform for both lecturers to exchange the idea regarding the implementation of medical curriculum in both countries. In line with organization of this symposium, it hopes that academicians from both countries can exchange their view and idea on the implementation of medical program in their respective university, especially involving the anatomy subject. In addition, perhaps this symposium also can strengthen the relationship between the three universities in the field of medical education and medical research in the future. I hope that this symposium will be a platform for the academician to contribute their idea for a better implementation of medical curriculum globally, specifically for the both countries. With this symposium, it hopes that it can improve the implementation of medical education for both countries and further strengthen the cooperation in the field of medical education. The symposium is in line with the current trend, need and ever-changing medical field, while the medical course is very dynamic field and required modification from time to time. One of the important and oldest subjects in medical education is anatomy subject, and which we study about structure of human, that given special emphasis in this symposium. Apart from that, the organizer also have invited some of the local medical education experts from both countries to contribute in this symposium. I hope that by organizing the symposium then and participated with this symposium will enhance their knowledge in medical field, as well as will be able to strengthen their understanding through the implementation of medical curriculum in line with the faster change in medical education field. Moreover, with your presence on these 2 days symposium, perhaps this symposium will be a more opportunity for the lecturers to interact with each other and exchange their idea regarding the medical course. Finally, I would like to echo again my express deepest appreciation and thank to all involved and work hard to make this symposium become successful. Hopefully, with your presence today, it will be further invitements this symposium and organizer will be able to achieve the objective that have been planned. With the word of Bismillahirrahmanirrahim, I thereby officiate the opening of the Anatomy and Health Sciences Symposium. Thank you very much. Bye, Soe Spasiba.
Thank you, Professor Hatta Mak Rasik, for your kind welcoming speech as well as opening ceremony for today. Hopefully with the kalam Bismillah, we'll help smooth our symposium for today and tomorrow. Testing, sorry. Dr. Tapi, can you hear my voice now?
Yeah, Dr. Shaz.
Sorry, this is the challenge of the virtual symposium. Sometimes we have to use all the technologies to help the others to listen to us. Now I would like to invite our second guest for today. Welcome speech from His Excellency Nail M. Latifov, Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Russian Federation to Malaysia. Please welcome.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you clearly. Yes. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very good morning for our Russian participants in Volgograd and Astrakhan City, and very good afternoon for our Malaysian colleagues here in KL and in Sarawak. First of all, let me express my deepest gratitude for to be invited to deliver this welcoming remarks on the occasion of the Anatomic and Allied Health Sciences Symposium. And it's my pleasure and honor to be here with you. I would like to begin with a statement that Russian government pay a very special attention to the developing relations with Malaysia, and we think that Malaysia is a very important partner for Russia in Southeast Asia. Our relations are based on the long traditions of trust, mutual understanding, and cooperation. And I also would like to inform you that this year our countries marked the 55th anniversary of establishment of diplomatic relations. We have a very stable and good political dialogue between our countries. Our countries have a similar or very close position on different international issues. We work together on different international issues on ASEAN framework and in different international organizations. One of the key instruments of developing bilateral relations is a joint Russia-Malaysia Commission on Economic, Scientific, Technical and Cultural Cooperation. And we held the first meeting of this commission in 2019 and are now working to prepare the second meeting. We really hope that we will be managed to organize it this year. And I would like to stress one more that in general we have a very good bilateral relations, but at the same time I am convinced that the time has come to give an additional impetus to development of our cooperation on a wide range of issues. And I strongly believe that we have a very good opportunities in scientific cooperation, especially in medicine. Our countries, Malaysia and Russia, have a long and glorious history of cooperation in this sphere. About 6,000 Malaysian students graduated from different Russian medical universities. Every year, about 70-80 hundred of Malaysian students went to Russia to study medicine. And I'm very glad that Volgograd Medical University is one of the universities where our Malaysian friends are studying. And I really hope that very soon Astrakhan Medical University will be the next point where Malaysian students can study medicine. And I would like to use this opportunity to express my deepest gratitude to the leadership of University Sains Malaysia and leadership of Volgograd Medical University and Astrakhan Medical University for organizing this symposium. I'm convinced that it's a very good platform to exchange views on different medical issues, scientific issues, and to outline ways of mutually beneficial cooperation for the future. And in the conclusion, I would like once more express my deepest appreciation to the organizers of this symposium, and wish to all the participants good luck and all of success. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for your kind speech, for the welcoming speech. So in Russia it's morning, in Malaysia evening. So hopefully we can have our second or following symposium. We try to have this feedback whether it's suitable for your site as early as 8 o'clock in the morning. Now we will have our third welcoming speech from our associate professor, Dr. Vladimir Shakrin. He's the chancellor of Volgograd State Medical University from Volgograd, Russia. Before we let our professor to share his welcoming speech, I would like to read his CV for your all participants. He is also a deputy chairman of the Volgograd Region Administration Committee on Health Protection, member of the Commission for National Projects and Priority Development Projects of the Volgograd Region, head of the Department for Public Health of the Institute of Continuing Medical and Pharmaceutical Education, and associate professor of Orthopedic Dentistry Department of Volgograd State Medical University. He graduated with honors from the Volgograd State Medical University with a degree in dentistry in 1999. And PhD in Medicine, Doctor of Medical Sciences in 2021. Over the years, he has more than 200 research and academic papers have been published. So, welcome. Thank you.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. I would like to welcome you all here on behalf of Volgograd State Medical University. I'm honored to have the opportunity to speak today at the Anatomical and Allied Health Science Symposium, Medical Education in Malaysia and Russia. The presentations at the symposium highlight the importance of preclinical medical education as a core part of future doctors' knowledge. This is important for any medical education program, since the foundation of a specialist's knowledge depends on the preclinical education stage. It is great that Malaysia and Russia are working together in this area. In my welcome speech, I would like to focus briefly on the most significant issues in skills shaping of our students. Volgograd Medical University is an integral educational, research, innovation and production complex. And the graduates follow the best traditions of the medical education as professors and researchers. That is why we pay special attention to the education quality. Regarding preclinical medical education, I'd like to point out that work in this area begins even before our future students are enrolled at university. For this purpose, we have created the pre-university center. It consists of a school of young medics, medical and biological classes, and a preparatory department for Russian students. Now there are 720 high school pupils and 52 programs of additional education for children. The School of Young Medics provides early career guidance in the biomedical field using project-based research activities. The biomedical classes provide in-depth study of specialized subjects. The programs are integrated into the educational process of 13 public schools. The preparatory department annually trains over 200 schoolchildren in programs to prepare them for the state examination in core subjects. This is all integrated into the system of personalized education implemented at Volgograd State Medical University. This approach has already proven effective. Graduates of biomedical classes successfully enroll in universities. In 2021, 88% of the census graduates were enrolled in universities across the country, of which around 60% were enrolled at Volgograd State Medical University and College. Moreover, summer and winter schools, workshops and seminars run on a regular basis by their leading international specialists during the main training period, allowing you to explore the most complex areas of modern medicine in depth. Volgograd State Medical University is a research and educational complex that implements a multi-level system for training professional healthcare specialists. Our graduates have successfully found jobs in healthcare institutions in the region, in the country, and all over the globe. The Symposium Medical Education in Malaysia and Russia will be attended by my colleagues, Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Associate Professor Dr. Sergei Poroisky, and Chairman of the Research Council of Young Researchers and Students, Daniel Lipov. They will speak more about the opportunities offered by the mechanisms implemented at our university. Innovations in anatomy, teaching and study, 3D technology in teaching and studying, the role of students, competitions in medical education. These and other topics will be discussed during this symposium today. I find them highly relevant. I wish you all fruitful work.
Thank you very much to Associate Professor Dr. Vladimir. So now we have our fourth welcoming speech from Professor Dr. Olga Vashkina, Director of Astrakhan State Medical University. Before we let she to share the welcoming speech, I would like to read her CV. Again, a medical doctor from Skanov University, Russian Federation, PhD from Orenburg University, Russia, graduated from Astrakhan State Medical University in 1985. Under her leadership, the experience successfully defended for 17 PhD and one medical doctor. Her main interests are related to the study of cellular and molecular mechanism of immunoregulation and the development of secondary immunodeficiency, innovative technologies for the diagnosis and treatment of immunodependent, allergic, somatic and infectious disease among the children. She developed and implemented a number of innovative methods of immunocorrection. she also a chairman of the Scientific Council of Astrakhan State Medical University, author of more than 250 publications, 70 patents for invention, 3 innovative proposals, 3 monographs, 3 methodological recommendations, as well as 6 textbooks and 1 manual for doctors. Kindly welcome for the welcoming speech, Dr. Olga. Thank you.
Dear Professor Mr. Ahmad Khatib bin Razif, dear colleagues, I am glad to greet you at the International Forum of Medical Education in Malaysia and Russia. Astrakhan State Medical University is the oldest university in Russia. We have been teaching foreign citizens from various countries of the world since 1992. Today, Astrakhan Medical University is one of the largest international campuses in the southern region of Russia. Every third student in our university is a foreigner. Studying at the university attracts young citizens from 97 countries, mostly from the countries of South and North Africa. Students attach their future professional in 3 languages, English, French, and Russian. Educational programs are developed in the basis of international educational programs, while taking into account various international and national clinical recommendations and professional standards. This approach is due to the fact that practical healthcare requires a doctor to meet effective standards for treatment and diagnosis of diseases based on the principles of evidence-based medicine. However, a new model of healthcare is very popular in today's world, the so-called 4P medicine, the medicine of the future. It got its name from 4 basic principles. First P, prediction. Second P, prevention. Third P, personalization. Fourth P, participation. 4P medicine is a certain ideology that focuses on individual approach to the patient. The new paradigm means that modern medicine should be addressed to each person individually, should be preventive, and not be focused on the diseases that already developed. The patient should become a full-fledged partner of the doctor. It's especially effective to use this approach from the first years of the person's life, when based on the predisposing factors and genetic predisposition, we can predict the onset of the disease, and as a result, effectively prevent it. For example, in pediatrics, an important place is given to the first 1,000 days of a person's life. What disease an adult will or will not get sick with to a large extent depends on the nutrition, physical activity, and the development of mental abilities. In my opinion, modern medical education should be built in accordance with these fundamentally different trends. This is a complex, multi-stage process. During the training, the theoretical foundation of knowledge, the foundations of clinical thinking are laid, and practical skills are acquired. Simulation and IT technologies, 3D modeling and robotics have firmly entered the educational process. Today's medicine is developing so rapidly that it becomes necessary to teach super modern technologies at the university that are not yet in everyday practice. On an international scale, this is a huge task. Today, medical universities in different countries train specialists of the future. Only the consolidation of our efforts, the exchange of the most effective practices in medical education, will allow us to prepare truly successful specialists. They will have to solve the problems of oncological and cardiovascular diseases, defeat new infections, and when human life longer and healthier. I hope that the conference will help find new approaches to the implementation of medical education and will contribute to the expansion and strengthening of cooperation between universities. I wish you all successful work. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Olga, for the nice speech. Thank you for all the our special invited guests from Malaysia as well as from Russia. Now is 2:06 o'clock in Malaysia. Before we continue with our plenary one, hopefully we can have our symposium photo group since we have our all the special guests from Malaysia and Russia. However, if you can open your video, so you can on your video and we can have our technical team to assist for our photo group session. Okay, we will give time for you about few minutes to on your video and then let our technical team to screenshot for the photo group. Thank you. Just now I mentioned in the chat box, if you have can use our background, but it's okay. Just use just on your video, no problem. With your big smile, Mr. Romina, can you give sign whether you are ready, and I will let the our participant and special guest who ready.
The first group get ready and we just wave our hand, right? 3, 2.
Okay, ready, everybody? Big smile.
So the next group get ready. 2, 1. Just wave your hand.
Okay, with the count 1, 2, 3. Since we have so 267 participants, so our technical team will have few pages to screenshot for the all participants. Hopefully you can maintain smile.
Okay, we are done.
Done, okay. Thank you very much to Mr. Romina as our technical team for today. Okay. Thank you for all the our special guests and also our participants for your kind keep our cooperation for join us for today. So before we begin our plenary number one, we will have a short break about 2 minutes before we start our plenary number one.
Dr. Shaz, can you hear me?
Good afternoon, Dr. William. Yes, I can hear you clearly, very well.
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. Visual clear, fast.
Thank you.
Welcome. So, are you ready?
Yes, yes.
Okay. If you're ready, I will read your CV first before you can share your presentation. Is it okay, Dr.
Yes.
William?
Yes.
Okay. So, okay. Thank you to all participants for your kind waiting. After waiting for this evening session for symposium, I would like to share our first plenary speaker for today. Associate Professor Dr. William, he also from UNIMAS. He is Head of Pharmacology Unit and Problem-Based Learning Coordinator, Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences, University of Malaysia Sarawak. He obtained his education and academic qualification, Bachelor of Pharmacy in 1989, University of Sydney, Australia, Fellow of the Society of Hospital Pharmacists of Australia in 1995, Master of Science in Molecular Pharmacology in 2001, and Doctor of Philosophy in Molecular Pharmacology in 2002 from University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, Michigan, USA. His areas of specialization is molecular pharmacology, cellular signaling, and medical education. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Assistant Professor Dr. William to share his topic on PBL in Malaysian medical schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Greetings to distinguished guests and colleagues in Malaysia and in Russia and elsewhere. Thank you to the committee for inviting me. Thank you for your hard work. Earlier this morning, some of us had problems trying to change our background. And I think with some advice, some of us managed to do that. And in life, we often face problems for which we have to find a solution and then we learn something new. We were not given a lecture on how to change background. Even if the committee gave us 20 lectures on 20 PowerPoint problems, by the time we encountered the problem, I don't think we can remember the lecture. And so that was the situation facing some medical professors in McMaster University, Canada, in the 60s when they were asked to start a new medical school. These professors faced a problem in their previous medical schools. They found that they taught their courses very well, very solid courses to the preclinical students, and they gave them very difficult exams, and they passed all the exams. But when they were brought to the clinical postings and asked questions for which they already passed the exams, they could not remember. And so the professor said that we need to start a medical school in which we can override this problem. And so these are the three aims of their new medical school. Number one, they want to teach in such a way that the knowledge can be retrieved when it's needed later on. And number two, apart from knowledge, they want to teach a way of thinking. They want to teach clinical reasoning. And number three, they want to teach in such a way that when the students graduate, they are able to have the skills to cope with problems they have never seen before. And with this new way or their new curriculum, these are the few distinctive features. Number one, the students will be learning in small groups of people. And number two, the learning begins not with a lecture, but with a problem, a realistic and complex problem that serves as a stimulus for their thinking. Number three, they do not encourage passive listening to lectures because the way of learning is active discovery. And lastly, the academic staff that's with them is not a teacher. The academic staff is a partner in learning, someone who facilitates their learning. And so with these distinctive features of PBL, they call this problem-based learning. And this problem-based learning, they practice it and then they share it in medical education conferences. And people from other countries heard their new approach. They went to McMaster for a while and learned how they do problem-based learning. And then they went back to their home countries and implemented it into their home medical schools. And in this way, PBL spread in the 70s. And by the 80s, PBL has gone to many, many countries. And over now, in the 2000s, PBL has spread into most parts of the world. And this editorial from the British Medical Journal sums it up. It says, although this is 12 years old, it says that PBL is probably the most influential innovation in medical education during the past 40 years, which is now 50 years. So a very big statement for something that started basically in the 60s. So now I'd like to bring us closer to home and look at how PBL started in our homeland here in Malaysia. USM, or University of Science Malaysia, is our third medical school. Our third medical school. A senior academic went to UK and discovered PBL. He came back, and when USM started their first batch of students in 1981, they implemented PBL. So PBL came into Malaysia in the early 80s, starting with USM. Some years after that, UKM, with already existing medical school, modified their curriculum to incorporate PBL. And some years after that, the private medical school, IMU, also started fresh and put in PBL. And then comes to us here in UNIMAS. We had a medical educator from UKM come over to help us develop our first curriculum for our first batch of students in 1995, also beginning with PBL. And University of Malaya, and the oldest medical school, modified their curriculum in 1999, incorporating PBL. And after that, there's many, many other medical schools which had at various times put in various forms and put in PBL as well. So now I want to move to discuss about PBL itself. We see that the word is PBL, not PBT. The focus is not on teaching, because you can teach a lot, but the students may not learn. Rather, PBL is focusing on how to help learners learn. And when some people think about PBL, they think it's about problem solving. Problem solving is a different subject. In PBL, the problems is used as a trigger or a stimulus to learn new knowledge. And so, according to one of the founders of PBL, the definition here in front of us is PBL is the learning that results from the process of working toward the understanding or resolution of the problem. So the problem comes first, and the problem may not be solved because it depends on what you reveal to the students, but the problem in trying to understand the problem comes the learning, which they are supposed to do. So is PBL something that you can add on to your curriculum, one of the many, many methods? According to the founders of PBL, PBL is not a method, it is actually a curriculum, meaning that it has a certain philosophy. So it cannot be added on, but rather all elements of the curriculum must be in line with the PBL philosophy. And these are some of the approaches that came up in the last 50 years as well, which are consistent with the PBL philosophy. So later on, I'll be mentioning about what is needed to run a PBL curriculum. I will only focus on PBL, but here are some of the approaches that can be added on together with PBL as a partner to PBL, which is consistent with the PBL philosophy. And so now it's already Master PBL Medical is already 50 years old, or rather, to be exact, 53 years old. So is PBL still here? Where is PBL going? I show here the Malaysian Higher Education Ministry, which came up with the education blueprint. And the blueprint was designed in order to help our education stay up to date with the fourth industrial revolution. And we have a higher education framework for that. And I want to point our attention to the future-ready curriculum. And in this future-ready curriculum, I want to bring us to the transformative learning and teaching delivery. Do you think PBL is among the transformative learning and teaching delivery? And there are, if you look at the listing such as this one of different transformative learning and teaching delivery, PBL is definitely one of them. This is all for a list of different disciplines. But I think I missed a slide, so I'm going to move back one step. Yeah. So in our higher education ministry, the transformative learning and teaching delivery uses learning with lectures. And instead, it is the process, the various approaches that's consistent with the transformative approaches will include PBL, as I circle here, and various other approaches as well. PBL, as you can see, is still very much one of the part of the future curriculum. So now I want to bring us back to the Malaysian medical schools. So I'm going to do a very quick survey of some medical schools that is using PBL to look at their implementation. So I'm looking at the 2 years of preclinical studies in which these schools will have so-called PBL triggers. So typically one trigger or one problem or one case is given to the students to resolve in 1 week. So now I'm doing a survey on how many PBL triggers do the students encounter in their preclinical 2 years. And here's the results that I got. You can see that there is a variety of numbers, but I do not have the data for the other approaches that they use in conjunction with PBL. I only have the data on PBL alone. It's only with the other site data can we make a conclusion on the curriculum philosophy. But here is only a snapshot of the number of problem case learning cases or triggers that they have in the 2 years. So UNIMAS, we are right there and on the second place, just below University of Malaya. So now I'd like to move on to the second topic, which is for those interested to start a PBL curriculum, what are the things that they have to put into place? So basically, this is the resources for PBL. And I want to start off with the physical, the building itself, the infrastructure. And so for a UNIMAS, our PBL rooms are all on the ground floor in one area of our building. And the rooms are arranged such that it is all in a cluster, as can be seen in the slide on the right. And so these rooms that we have are purpose-built for PBL. Often medical schools use rooms for multiple purposes, but we were able to have our own purpose-built rooms because we planned for it before the construction of our building. So if you are able to plan before the building starts, then you can put in those special rooms for PBL. And now I'd like to take us look at the equipping of the room. Every room would have the screen here, as well as the LCD projector up here, which can connect the students' laptops to project onto the screen. In addition, there is the whiteboard for them to draw on. And this room also shows the air conditioning unit. So this is an example of the students connecting the laptop to the projector so that they can, in this case, show an animation that explains a certain molecular situation. Animations are very useful. It can explain certain sequences and processes in a way much better than pictures or just talking. And so here's an example of the use of the showing animation to each other. So in the room, we have the table, and in the middle of the table, it opens up with a lot of sockets for the devices that the students require. We also equip each room with a visualizer. A visualizer is very useful machine. As you can see, the student here is putting a tablet below the visualizer. Whatever is put below the visualizer, projected onto the screen. So that's a very useful way for the students to share their notes, their books, in a way that can be seen by everyone clearly just by putting it under the visualizer without making any special preparations. So that's very useful for the discussion stage. In the rooms, you also have the shelves, as I mentioned, the whiteboard, and every room will be equipped with a medical dictionary and a laser pointer for them to do their discussion. Outside the room, we have two wireless routers for that area of PBL rooms. And so the Wi-Fi is internet Wi-Fi is provided for that area of the building. That is, I mentioned, is internet Wi-Fi. Nowadays, when people use video conferencing, that is a little bit inadequate because that takes a lot of bandwidth. But for normal internet use, our Wi-Fi is sufficient. So that was the infrastructure. I want to move on. Since there are many anatomies here, I want to move on to some things of anatomy that is discussed in the PBL room. We have an anatomy museum where the students can go in and take advantage of these exhibits, these specimens, models and charts. They can borrow this from the museum to bring it into the PBL rooms so that they can discuss the topic of anatomy with their friends. Here's an example where the students have brought a model and using the model to explain some things in the PBL room. And here is, I want to show you, the thing I'm circling here is not the student, it's a skeleton. Yeah, so they brought a skeleton in order to discuss parts, features of anatomy, and the screen is showing some aspects of the skeleton as well. Apart from these objects, some students also make use of apps. For example, this is an app from the Apple App Store in which it can be used to show various aspects of an anatomy which can be projected to the screen for the other students in the room. And the free version is very useful to show the skeleton, and you can turn the skeleton around, and you can also focus in. But the paid version has more features. Here, I show you a very quick example of the students showing me on the iPad what the paid version can do. So in the paid version, you can turn around and you can see the muscles in relationship to the skeleton, and you can highlight certain features that you want to see. You can focus on parts that you want to see. So these are a very useful tool in which the students can discuss anatomy by using an app. So this is a couple of examples that I want to bring up in regards to discussion or anatomy subjects. So moving on from the room itself, we need a lot of training if you want to start a PBL curriculum. For example, we need to train our staff to become PBL facilitators. They are no longer teachers, but they become supporters of learning. And that is something quite new to many. And so we need our staff to go through our workshop before they can become PBL facilitators. So we conduct these annual workshops. In addition, our students are mostly unfamiliar with PBL. So I need to train all of them how to do PBL just before their first PBL session. They need to go through 1 week in which they do a practice PBL before they go to the PBL rooms to do the real one. So students also need to be trained to do PBL. And then in order to, as I mentioned, the problem triggers, these are all written. And so we need people to help to write these triggers for the various blocks that we have. And not just the triggers, but also the notes, because we need our facilitators to understand the background of the triggers. We need to write the notes explaining the clinical details. And we also provide reading materials like review articles that give further background for those facilitators who has no medical background, especially in that area. And so there's a lot of need to be preparing and writing all these notes in order to support the PBL. The students only see the problems, right? And we need to constantly review and refresh our problems, improve it further. And so there's a lot of work needed in the writing. And lastly, the assessment. And PBL is for learning the curriculum. So we have our regular exams to do the assessment. But students' participation can also be graded. And there are different ways to grade the students. But the methods that you use to grade the students must be consistent with PBL philosophy, which is that the students take ownership of their own learning. They do not put on a show for you. They are learning in an authentic way. Therefore, we are transitioning to an alternative assessment that can help the student to improve themselves as learners, right? Instead of a teacher-centered grading, whereby the students would then be doing something to show you, but we want to have authentic assessment that can help the students to become even better learners without taking away the fact that PBL is not teacher-centered. It is actually a student-centered approach where the students must take full ownership of their learning. Okay, so that is briefly the resources that you need if you want to think of incorporating PBL into the curriculum. The rest of the time, I want to bring us to more recent events. As we all know that 2 years ago, there was a worldwide pandemic which has a big drastic effect on education, where schools were closed and universities were closed. And for us, in the month of March 2020, our students can no longer attend classes in person. So we had immediately to move from a face-to-face PBL to a remote PBL. At first, our students were still on campus. Later on, they went back to their homes. And then from that point on, in most of the 2 years, we were miles away from them. And so it's very different to seeing each other face-to-face, to seeing each other on a small little screen with no faces most of the time. And so as the rest of the world struggled to cope with this pandemic and put everything online, we first of all got everyone in every group to be inside a messenger app. And with this messenger app, this is their way of communication, whereby the students will announce to the facilitator and to everybody else when is their video conference meetings. And the facilitator would also give the problems to the students through this messenger app. And the students would be using this app, as you can see, to share information, even during the video conferencing, as well as 24 hours, 24/7. So messenger app became very important means of communication when they are not seeing each other face to face. And then when it comes to time for the PBL, as you expect, video conferencing is used. And as you can see on the left, it's simulating students writing down the ideas on the whiteboard. This is not a whiteboard, but it is the best that they can do, which is to write down what they are talking and what they are thinking. And on the right will be typically sharing the information that they want to show each other, pictures or diagrams, which they use to discuss. And as you can see below, these people are very far, many, many, many hundred miles from each other. And that's all they have. We are connected by video conference and we are talking to each other, but hearing each other and looking at each other, usually on only the face or else not even the face. So you can see that the communication is very, very different, but like the rest of the world, we moved our PBL online as well. And then I made a survey of our students at the end of the period in which they finished their first 2 years. This group of students, they started with face-to-face and then the pandemic struck and then they changed to online PBL for the rest of their year. That means that they did 1/3 face-to-face and the final 2/3 online. I asked them, what do you think of face-to-face versus online? And this is what they said. They said that I asked them, do you have adequate facility for video conferencing? Do you have internet in your house? Do you have a device that you can use for yourself? And about 9.6 or 10% say no. About 10% says they don't have good internet. They don't have a suitable device, right? That's quite similar to statistics from schools as well. I asked them, do you have a suitable place for video conferencing? Do you have your own room? Or are you forced to use a common room where you are distracted by noise and by people and have a lack of privacy? Do you have your own space? And 13% of them says, no, I don't have my own space. So once again, there is a segment of people who find it difficult to do this type of video conferencing because they don't have a private room. They are often possibly disturbed by noise and people. And lastly, I asked them, if you were to go on like this, how do you feel about online learning? Do you feel positive about online learning? You want to go on as an online learner? And significant 23% says, no, I do not want to go on in online learning. This is already after more than 1 year of online learning. I asked them for the reasons. I share with you a few of the reasons I got. The first one is a literal pasting of what the person said. The person said that online learning only foster a short attention span. And we have pandemic anxiety that prevents our concentration. And after a while, looking at the screen is bad because you know the screen emits a blue light and some people cannot take it. It makes them nauseous. Now blue light can make you like stay awake and you know it changes your physiology a little bit, right? And after many hours of watching videos on the screen, it creates a tightness and a certain stress that you don't get in a face-to-face class. The second comment was that it is not motivating. It is demotivating to be interacting with a small screen. The screen is very small. And compared to a class where you are immersed 360 degrees, a screen is actually the size of one hand or two hands. It is very small to focus on that as your source of learning. Number three, they found it hard to concentrate because oftentimes the internet will lag and then they lost a little bit of what happened in the past few minutes. They couldn't hear, they couldn't see, people couldn't see them, people couldn't hear them. Sometimes they even have to leave and come back again. Sometimes they never come back. And with noises, sometimes I hear the noises behind my students' house. I can hear the cars, the people, the chickens, and the dogs. Yes, it's difficult to concentrate. And lastly, some of them said they are losing interest because if you go on for 1 year and 2 years compared to in-person classes, interest is being lost. And that, I think that's why for the 23%, they said, no, I do not want to continue in online learning. And I think that's a similar expressions around the world because it's not just education going online, but the people are under stress. They cannot go out. The families under stress, they lost income. It was a very stressful time and that impacted education as well. So I asked them this important question then. If you can come back to face-to-face, you have a choice. You can do face-to-face, you can do online, or you can do both, what would you choose? And this group, you can see that significant, almost half, 49%, said, I want to go back to in-person. And only one-third said, yeah, I want to do it online. Only one-third. Majority would say either go back to in-person or mixture of both. And this is after doing online for 70% for most of their time in with us. They prefer to be not online. Now I asked the other group. You see, this other group is the opposite. This group, they started with face-to-face for 70%. They only did online for the last 30%. They are almost fully face-to-face. But with a little bit of online, you ask them, which one do you want? You can see the vast majority, 80% says, I want to continue face-to-face. I do not want to stay online. Only 10% says they want to stay online. So overall, you can see that the response of our students with various exposure to online learning, online PBL, says that, no, we prefer face-to-face PBL. I think that should be the same conclusion as well if you were to do it, the survey in your own schools. And so now I want to take a snapshot again of our medical schools here. Are they doing online? Or are they face-to-face? And you can see that UNIMAS and UKM are right now face-to-face, right? And UM is still online. I want to make a disclaimer. This is a survey taken last week. At any time, this can change, all right? So this is true for last week because we are moving very fast right now. So as of last week, University of Malaya is online. University of Pattaya, Malaysia is up to you. You can stay online or you can go to the classes. They let the people decide. UITM, and USM, they differentiate between year one and year two. For UITM, year one has to be face-to-face because they already come back to campus, whereas year two has to be online because they are not in campus yet. Same for USM, where the year one is not in campus, Year two is on campus, but they still give them a choice. You can go online or you do face-to-face. If this is UNIMAS, I know what the students will choose, right? You know what the students will choose. And so that is where we are. We are in a state of coming back from the pandemic going back to face-to-face. So the remaining time, I want to document our journey to go back to face-to-face. We have survived the pandemic. We are now coming back. How do you come back in the pandemic to do face-to-face learning, to do face-to-face PBL? So we have our own standard operating procedures. I want to bring us through a little bit. If a person is a student has a symptoms, flu symptoms, or under isolation or quarantine, they cannot come to the PBL room. And then when they come to the PBL room, we show them the way to walk and distancing as well, which is very hard to implement as you can understand. In the PBL room, you have to scan the QR code for our contact tracing app. And then inside the room, you have to open the window even as you turn on the air conditioning. And the fans will be the backup to the air conditioning. So we want to have a constant flow of air by getting all the windows open. And inside the PBL room, the distancing must be maintained. And we have placed the chairs at certain positions. But as you understand, when you're in the middle of PBL, things can change. But this is the understanding. We need to keep distancing. And we need to be wearing our mask from the moment we step out of our college. We are supposed to stay masked all the time, a proper mask, properly worn. And yes. And then finally, we offer our students, for those that's affected by the pandemic in that they have symptoms of flu or they are under quarantine or isolation, we want to include them in the PBL, even though they cannot come to the class. So we have designed a hybrid PBL whereby if they have symptoms, quarantine, isolation, the PBL students in the PBL room would switch to video conference. And so by doing that, those people in the PBL room will be seeing each other, hearing each other, but they will also allow the person back in the home to be able to listen and see and based on the screen that's being shared with them. So as you can see here, even though this is a face-to-face PBL, but the screen is showing a video conference going on. Okay, so in a way, it is both. It is both, although it is not as anything done that is outside of the screen will not be seen by the people at home. So it is not ideal, but it is a way in which we, during the pandemic, include those who are unfortunately unable to turn up for some time, 1 week or 2 weeks. And here I want to show you the student who was at home, and he came on the screen to say hi to me, and that's where he is. And I'm on the other side where he can see. And I'm being captured by the camera on the tablet right here. So here we go. We are able to see each other, but I see a screen and he sees a screen. All right. But otherwise, at least the rest in the room are able to interact. I think that is the basically what I want to share for this afternoon. So we have PBL, which started 53 years ago, and PBL has survived. It is part of the Malaysia's future curriculum. We have not only survived, we have survived the pandemic, and we are now coming back. We are coming back and to be face-to-face again. I want to thank our year two students from the two cohorts that I got my survey from. I want to thank all my fellow colleagues in UNIMAS who are serving as facilitators, who are serving to help in doing the trigger writing and other documentation. I want to thank everyone this afternoon for your kind attention. Thank you very much, Dr. Shas. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm supposed to stop sharing, right? Right. I'm having a problem with that.
Thank you, Associate Professor Dr. William, for the kind informative and sharing throughout the pre-COVID as well as an endemic, as pandemic and also endemic. Maybe I will try to provide during the 2 years of PBL, right? I also one of the facilitators for year two in UNIMAS. I can't forget when I start to share with the students, suddenly I hear their mom shouting at the back, mentioned their daughter name to pick up the clothes because raining. So I say I have to respond to the student, it's okay, you can go to respond to your mom first, we wait for you. So I think that the beauty of a virtual PBL. But I think I agree with Prof. William, as your survey is very clear-cut, how students are willing to have face-to-face of PBL, okay? So I hope, I think I've got one participant asked Prof. William just now, how the assessment in PBL? Maybe you can have a short explanation to the participant.
Dr. Shaz, you're asking about assessment, is it?
How the assessment in the PBL?
Yeah. Right. Our PBL in assessment in PBL comprised 10% of the examination, and so in the past we actually have used what many use a rubric for the facilitator to assess the student, and that is very ununiform. Some people give a lot of marks. Some people give very few marks. But the worst part is that is very teacher-centered. That is making the teacher the authority figure, which is what you do not want. And so we have stopped that now. We are now giving a mark for the whole group, not on individual students, but for the whole group so that they can help each other to improve their participation. But in the future, as I mentioned, we should move on to a alternative assessment where it's not dependent on the facilitator. The facilitator is a support in learning, not an assessor. We need to come up with a assessment whereby it's not just an assessment, but it also helps the students to become better in their learning. For example, peer assessment. In peer assessment, the students learn how to grade other people at the same time they learn how to improve themselves, because they are supposed to grade people the same way in which the others are supposed to grade him. And not only do they you get one person grading one person, but nine persons will grade one person, and we get an average of the results. So this is a much more fair and balanced way of assessment. And there are many other alternative assessments which gives a more authentic assessment than a teacher-centered assessment. So we are still in the process, Dr. Shaz, in the process of coming up with something better.
Thank you very much. Dr. Hussam, can you unmute your mic? I can read for you in the chat box. Dr. William, Dr. Hussam asked one question. What is the best method to facilitate a PBL for our students which they are not same as in overseas school? Which students will student biology and well prepared before to go to medical school? Some more than the type of students going to private schools, they are not the best students in the country and the level around A to B level.
Right. The question best is about method, the intake,
yeah, the best method
intake to facilitate of the students. Yeah. Yes, so the students are, is it Dr. Shaz, that the students are having different levels when they come into medical school? Is that the question?
True. Yeah. I believe in Malaysia, we only, our medical student only the same level after their secondary school, but in other countries, they allow the degree level to join.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello? Okay, thank you. Dr. William, for this great lecture ever I hear in my life. And actually, my question is about our real situation in Malaysia. And because you, as I like the point you said, BBL is not something you just inserted in your curriculum. You have to adapt the curriculum totally. You know, so I agree with you. Our curriculum, actually, what we do is what you said, we just inserted. So the curriculum is not really that matching. And the problem we face is with students. Our students in Malaysia, they are not well prepared for medical school, for BBL, same like overseas. Overseas, they will study biology extra, you know, very well. So there are different students, number one. Number two, as I teach in different, some private university medical school. You know, the one that come from private, they are the remnant. which they cannot go for scholarship outside, they cannot go for the main government university, and then they will come to us. So those level from A to B, there is maybe one in 40 or one in 52, two or three maybe in the group, they are, you can say they are great, but the other really around B plus, something like that. So very difficult. Even if we give them a student teaching workshop for the what is the class, we read me keep repeat everything in the classes. I tell you, I need the student at the end of the semester two. We have in semester one and in semester two. I meet the student in the last class at the semester two, means they go already more than 10 BBL session and they still like very primitive. Very difficult. And my question here is what the facilitator should do, because here the facilitator really need to be a teacher. The BBL turn into a lecture, no more a BBL. And that will take more time and long time, and start 2 hours is not enough at all if you want to really make a good student understand everything. So what is the best method or advice you can tell us to do in like this situation to maximize our performance? Thank you very much, and sorry for the long time.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Husam. Yes, the first question was the students coming from different levels. In fact, our students as well. Our students in the pre-university can be from the foundation course, can be from the matriculation course, or can be from the STPM course, and there are differences as well. So when you form the PBL groups, you must not form them according to alphabetical order or according to their friends. You must mix the students. You must put in every group some of the students from the higher level, some from the medium level, some of them from the lower level. Every group must be balanced so that every group will have people who are able to help each other. So first, you must balance the groups. And second one is that you see, PBL has been done for primary school as well. And I know that they know very much less than your students. So PBL is a situation whereby you bring a problem in which they will encounter in future. In hospital, I presume. You give them a problem that can be encountered in the future in the hospital. You give that problem to them that makes them think. And as they think, they will try to find out for themselves what's going on with this problem. And whatever they learn this round will be their background for the next problem that you give them. And so you, if you test them, they will be a little bit deficient, because they do not go from chapter 1 to chapter 2, chapter 3 to chapter 4. They do not go from the front to the back of the textbook. They go some here, some here, some here, some here. It's more like an onion. They go deeper and deeper. You can only test them at the end. At the end, when you test them, they are the same as those who go from chapter 1 to chapter 2. It's just that the way they learn is going around in different direction, following their interests and following what they need to know, right? So you develop your curriculum, you put in problems that will cover the curriculum, and then they will be learning by trying to understand the problems. And so by this way, I hope that towards the end of the 1 year or 2 years, I would expect them to be similar in their knowledge compared to your previous students who did not do PBL. That's my brief understanding. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. And the small order, can you give us your email or how to contact with you, inshallah? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to Dr. Husam for the kind question. For those who have another question, also we can share our Associate Professor Dr. William email in the chat box later, so you can ask directly via email. Is it okay? Thank you very much. Thank you very much again to our Associate Professor Dr. William for the kind sharing and also answer all the questions from the participants. Now we would like to have our second plenary for today. We would like to have our Professor Dr. Marina Kapitanova. Let her to share her kind sharing. I would like to read her outstanding CV for her Professor Dr. Marina. She is currently working as Professor of Anatomy at the Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences of University of Malaysia Sarawak UNIMAS. She obtained her medical doctor from Institute of Rheumatology RFPhD from Sekinov, University from Russia. Graduated from the Volgograd State Medical University in 1981. She was a chief supervisor of the 4 Master Science and 10 PhD students in anatomy. Her main research interests include neuroendocrinology of stress, nanopharmacology of neurodegenerative diseases, and preclinical medical anatomical education. So we would like to welcome Prof. Marina to share her second plenary for today, entitled Updates on the Preclinical Medical in Russia and Malaysia. Kindly welcome. Sorry, Dr. William, can you help us to unshare the slide so that Prof. Marina can share her slide? Thank you.
Just, can you hear me now?
Yes, clear. Audio visual parts, thank you.
Dear Dr. Saiful Bahri bin Talib, our chairperson for today's symposium, dear colleagues, dear Russian colleagues, most welcome to our symposium, and very good morning to all of you, and very good afternoon to the Malaysian participants. Thank you so much for inviting me to be your speaker today. I will gladly share my experience in teaching of preclinical medicine in the Russian and Malaysian medical universities. It was 22 years ago when I came all the way down here to Malaysia from the beautiful city of Volgograd, my hometown on the Volga River, from the snowed up winters in Russia to the beautiful country Malaysia, with its iconic twin towers in Kuala Lumpur, with its incredible underwater world. And when I arrived in Malaysia, there were many things which amazed me. But the thing which amazed me the most was the level of the education in the Malaysian universities. And I tell you frankly, I was very much surprised to discover such a high standard of teaching of medicine in the Malaysian universities. From what I was knowing before I arrived in Malaysia, and many Russian participants may be also not knowing, Malaysia is quite a young country with young universities. By the time I joined USM, it was around 25 years old. And the oldest university, sorry. And the oldest university in Malaysia by that time was University Malaya, which was less than 40 years old by that time. You can see this is University Malaya, and this is, I'm attending the 40th anniversary of the anatomy department in the Faculty of Medicine in the University Malaya. So it was in 2004. And I was not the only one who was so much surprised. You can see the group of Australian lecturers who are visiting USM, which I joined in 2001. They're also very much impressed and very much amazed by the high standard of medical education in the Malaysian universities. And this, this is the evidence of the high level of higher education in Malaysia. You can see this is the results of the QS ranking in 2022. And one university, this is University of is in the first 100, and another four universities, UPM, UKM, USM, and UTM, are in the second 100. It means five universities of Russia are in the top 200, and this is a really very high score. And there is certain reason for this success of Malaysian medical education within a very short period of time. First of all, Malaysia is a part of the Commonwealth, and Malaysian lecturers are having access to the facilities and to the technologies of the established medical universities in the Commonwealth, in the United Kingdom and in Australia. And senior academic staff shared with me that the first thing they did when they started running medical programs in Malaysia, they did a benchmarking in the established universities of the United Kingdom and Australia. Another factor is Tun Mahathir Mohamad, who is called by many people a father of the nation. He was the fourth and the seventh prime minister in Malaysia, and he is having medical background. He used to be a family physician, and his wife is also a medical doctor. And before becoming a prime minister, he was a minister of education. Therefore, medical education in Malaysia was always given the highest priority. There are also many other factors which contributed to a very fast and successful development of the Malaysian medical education. As far as the Russian medical education is concerned, it has a long, glorious history, and the oldest university in Russia, this is medical faculty in the Moscow State University, which is now Sechenov University, was established more than 250 years ago. And we have two Nobel laureates in medicine, and of course, many more in other sciences, but in medicine, they are Ivan Pavlov in physiology and Ilya Mechnikov in immunology. And we have world-renowned medical doctors, and these days, Russian universities are running high-technology educational process. And if we compare the medical education in Malaysia and in Russia, I would say my experience of teaching both in Malaysia and in Russia, that they are ideal partners because they can nicely complement each other, because there are certain things which are very well developed in Malaysia and not very well developed in Russia, and vice versa. There are things which are very strong in the Russian medical education and which are missing in Malaysia. And I identified certain aspects of the possible collaboration in the areas which are different in Malaysia and in Russia. And first of all, I would like to emphasize the most impressive achievement of the Malaysian preclinical medical education. And of course, I'm talking today only about the preclinical medical education. This is integrated curriculum. As you all remember, the Flexner's report in 1910 changed the face of the medical education all over the world. And one of the principles which was proclaimed by the Flexner's curriculum was the vertical integration. It was the integration of the preclinical and clinical years in the medical education. But thereafter, as Dr. William already mentioned, certain clinical lecturers, and on this picture you can see two outstanding medical educators, or Barrows. He's a neurologist, and this is John Hamilton. He's a cardiologist, and they worked for McMaster University, and they really dissatisfied with the level of training of the students who graduated from preclinical years. And once they reached the clinical years, they really felt helpless, and they did not have enough skills and knowledge to adjust to the clinical environment. And therefore, they decided to reconsider the preclinical curriculum, and thus the integrated curriculum was introduced at McMaster University, and its cornerstone was problem-based learning. I will not focus on the problem-based learning, as we already listened to a very beautiful presentation by Dr. William, but I want to emphasize on the integrated curriculum. This is the design of the integrated curriculum in some of the Malaysian universities. It can be different. For example, this is the modules in the medical curriculum of the year one in UKM, and this one is for the UITM, and this, for the UNIMAS, and this one is for UITM. You can see there are certain things which are common. Let's say both UNIMAS and UITM start year one with general module and end with the endocrine module. And in between, there are different modules, blood in the UITM and let's say urinary system in UITM and blood in UNIMAS. But you can see that the modules in UKM are absolutely different. This is cellular biomolecules, tissues of the body, human genetics, membranes and receptors, clinical science module, personal professional development, metabolism, mechanisms of diseases, infection and immunity, and so on and so forth. So it means that Malaysia is having liberty, medical education is having liberty to choose their own curriculum and to tailor it according to the needs of their students, of their lecturers, and of the society. Unfortunately, and doesn't mean that the medical universities in Malaysia can choose any curriculum and do anything they want. Of course, there is multi-level system of control, the quality control, which is provided by the Senate at the university level, by the Ministry of Education, Ministry of Health, and MQA at the governmental level, and also by the external examiners, which are always attending the first professional exam, which takes place at the end of the second year. And let's say this is, you can see the photo of UITM, and they even used to have external examiners for the first professional exam from overseas. I remember one lecturer came from Monash to be the external examiner of the first professional exam in UITM. And besides the advisory boards, let's say the UITM was having advisory board, which included professors from Harvard University, University of London, and University of Melbourne. So obviously, so many levels of control of the quality of medical curriculum make it very adequate and very proper. On the contrary, in the Russian Federation, there are so-called federal state educational standards, which are very tough and very rigid. For example, there is the most recent standard of education is number 3, dated 2020. And of course, I cannot show you the whole thing because it is a huge, huge standard with so many disciplines. But I just want to show you one example of biochemistry. Biochemistry can be taught only in semester 2 and 3, and it should cover 115 hours. And there should be 36 lectures and 79 practicals. And there should be 65 hours of SDL. And the distribution of hours between the second and third semester should be 67 and 48. And the exam, which is VIVA, should be at the end of the third semester. Of course, you understand that with this tough and rigid educational standard, integration is almost impossible. Because, for example, you are teaching muscles in the first semester, and of course you need to show the chemical processes which take part in the muscles, but you cannot do it because biochemistry will join only in the second semester. And integrated curriculum has proved that it is very friendly to the lecturers and to the students, and there are so many benefits from the integrated curriculum. Therefore, I would like to recommend our Russian colleagues to work with the ministry to get maybe the to conduct a pilot project and to introduce integrated curriculum from which both lecturers and students and future patients will benefit. Another disadvantage of the subject-based curriculum, which is now being taught in Russia and in some other countries, is redundancies and overlappings and discrepancies. For example, preparing for this presentation, I went to the library and I took the textbooks of anatomy, histology, physiology, and biochemistry. And I opened on the same page. This is regarding kidney. And you will be surprised, you can do same experiment and you can check yourself, that there is a description of the structure of the nephron in all these textbooks. Besides, this is the structure of the nephron. And the way anatomists describe the structure of nephron is different from what histologists are writing. And this is different from what physiologists are writing. And this is different from biochemists are presenting. So it means that the students are supposed to learn the Handler's loop, for example, as anatomists understand it. Then they need to forget about it and to start learning Handler's loop explained by the histology, which is different. The composition of handless loop is different in histology compared to anatomy understanding. And then they shift to physiological version and to biochemical version of the structure, I emphasize, not chemistry, not physiology, that because the physiologist and biochemist, they are commenting on the structure of the nephron and handless loop. And this is information is different from the one which was presented by anatomists and by the histologist. So what should students do? They just forget all the four alternatives, because it's impossible to remember four variants of the structure of the nephron. And they don't know which is correct, which textbooks they should believe. That is why in many cases, I remember in Russia, I was asked by the students that the information in the textbook of anatomy and histology is different, and whom should we trust? Integrated curriculum deals with this problem, because of course, biochemists will never agree with physiologists on certain issues, and anatomists will never agree with the histologist on certain issues. But there should be demarcation. We just integrate the curriculum and we agree that, let's say, handless loop is being taught by histology. And other disciplines like anatomy, physiology, and biochemistry, they just refer to the information which was provided by the histology, and so on and so forth. And thus you save plenty of time and save a lot of space in the student's memory, so that they get at least clear understanding of what is nephron, or let's say what is pulmonary lobule, or what is adenohypophysis, what is neurohypophysis. There will be no more discrepancy in their mind, and they will have clear understanding, and they will be better prepared for the clinical years. Traditional or subject-based curriculum means overwhelming amount of content with reduced number of teaching hours, lack of real integration with other disciplines, redundancy between subjects as a result, emphasis on teaching rather than learning, and poor retention of knowledge. As I mentioned earlier, because of this very rigid educational standard, integrated curriculum is not possible now in Russia. But some of the departments and some of the universities try to do at least partial integration. For example, they integrate anatomy and pathology, or let's say pathological anatomy and pathological physiology. But this doesn't solve the problem, because the integrated curriculum works as a system. It can work as separate segments. Only system can work effectively. That is why my advice to the Russian colleagues to collaborate with UNIMAS and with other Malaysian universities, which have very good experience in integrated curriculum, and they can share ideas and approaches and facilities and whatever help is required. I understand I don't have much time, I just skip it. So, and similarly regarding problem-based learning, you may hear from some of the universities in Russia that they do have PBL. Of course, this is not exactly PBL, because PBL is a special philosophy. This is a special method of teaching, which was proposed by Howard Barrows, and any other modes of teaching, like, let's say, clinical situations or clinical scenario, they're not PBLs, because PBL is a system, and it cannot exist in, let's say, in one department, because all preclinical departments, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, microbiology, pharmacology, public health, should join together to conduct PBL. Then it works. But of course, medical universities have many advantages and many innovations, which also can be shared by the Malaysian universities. For example, I'm talking about teaching of anatomy, because I'm an anatomist. I can show you the 3D models, 3D printing, which is very common in the Russian medical universities these days, and anatomical tables, let's say the Pirogov anatomical table. We will be having a presentation tomorrow on this table, is now available in every medical university of Russia, and they're widely used. And this is, you will not believe that this is a class of surgery, this is anatomy. And this is how the practical skills training is being done at the practicals of anatomy, where the students are operating the animals. Another strength of Russian medical universities is students' Olympiads. What we do have students' Olympiads in Malaysia, but not so many. But here, Olympiad is a great event which involves thousands of students and these days Russia is conducting international Olympiads. And I wish and hope that Malaysia in the future will also be able to send students to Russia to participate in the anatomical Olympiads or any other disciplines, and students also will be able to come to Malaysia to participate in the Olympiads which are being conducted by the Malaysian universities. And another important, another strong suit of the Russian medical education is students' research. Of course, we do have certain research in Malaysian universities. For example, in UNIMAS, we are running elective program, but it's just a small episode in their life. While in the Russian medical institutions, the students' research is given the highest possible priority, and most of the students are involved in the scientific societies at different departments, or let's say they may even choose two departments, one preclinical and one clinical department, and they will be doing translational research. And this is the state of the art technologies used by the students. You can see the students are using immunohistochemistry and they're using electron microscopy. So this research is really of the high quality, and the students are publishing papers in the cited journals. And the annual research conferences are conducted in every university by every department, or maybe by the combination of the departments. For example, I'm conducting the anatomical research conference with the students in 2006. And the students also work with the animals. They're doing animal studies. They work with the laboratory animals. So this is a very common practice in the Russian medical universities, which may be shared by the Malaysian universities. And this is the another example of the students' conference in Astrakhan. You can see the two Malay girls. This is Andik and Aisha. They participated in this conference and they got the golden and the silver medal. So I wish and hope that in the future there will be many more international Russian-Malaysian students' conferences, and our students will be participating and will be, at the end of the day, becoming the better doctors. Thank you so much for your attention. And may I congratulate all the Muslim colleagues on the upcoming Hari Raya Eid Adil Fitri, and wish peace and prosperity to your families. Thank you for your attention and welcome to Borneo.
Thank you very much, Provarina, for the kind sharing and also the kind wishes in advance. Okay, so thank you for the all the participants. We have the question. You can type in the chat box, or if we have time later, we also can share Provarina's email in the chat box. Is it okay, Provarina, to share your email address to our participants?
Yes, sure. Thank you so much. Shaz, this is Dr. Williams' presentation, but it doesn't interfere. We still can share the screen. Okay. Let it be.
Yeah.
Quite possible just to overcome Dr. Williams' presentation, no problem. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I will remind Dr. Williams to unshare the slide later. Okay. No,
but
thank you very much to Prof. Marina again for the kind presentation and for the second plenary. So may we continue with our third plenary. So before I begin, to call our special chief from Peninsula, Malaysia. UNIMAS is at the other side of Malaysia, which is the West Malaysia. So Dr. Yasri is our speaker from Peninsula Malaysia. So before I let Dr. Yasri to share her third plenary, I would like to read his CV for all the participants. Okay, so Dr. Yasir Izzat bin Abu Bakar, he's a medical lecturer at the Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences, University Sultan Zainal Abidin, Terengganu, Malaysia. He obtained his medical doctor degree in 2005 from University Putra Malaysia, UPM, and Master of Science Clinical Anatomy in 2014 from University Science Malaysia. Now he's in his final year for PhD. Same university, University of South Malaysia. His field of specialization, surface anatomy education. Another research area that he interests also in anatomy education, clinical work-based instruction, as well as teaching model design. So without further ado, I would like to call upon our Dr. Yasro to share her third plenary entitled Effective Strategies in Teaching and Learning of Surface Anatomy. Kindly welcome. Thank you. Excuse me, Dr. Yasrul, can you unmute your mic?
Okay, sorry for that. You can hear me now?
Now, better clear. Your audio visual clear. Pass. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Dr. Shazrina, the chairperson. First of all, I would like to thanks to the organizer for inviting me in to be one of the speakers in this international wonderful symposium. I'm Dr. Yasrul from University Sultan Zainal Abidin. 3 years ago, I and my research team has started a research on the surface anatomy education. And there is one interesting fact that I want to share with all of you today. And the fact is that there was no single effective method to teach surface anatomy. However, there were several effective strategies that have been proven to be effective in surface anatomy education. Therefore, today I will share some of the effective strategies in the teaching and learning of surface anatomy. And I really hope that with my sharing, we can improve on the education of surface anatomy. Okay, this is the overview of my talk. It will be divided into three parts. In the first part, I will introduce about the surface anatomy and its importance. And then in the second part, I will talk about the transformation that occur around surface anatomy education. And finally, I will reveal the effective strategies and elements that can be implemented in surface anatomy education. So, surface anatomy refers to the knowledge of external features of human body that can be studied without performing a cadaveric dissection. It comprises two subdivisions, namely palpable anatomy. Palpable anatomy refers to the structure that lies beneath the skin and therefore can be palpated. And an example of this is like the sternal angle of Louis. And the second subdivision is the projectional surface. Projectional surface refers to the deeper structure like the heart. We cannot palpate the heart. However, we can use the projection surface, meaning that the underlying surface, such as the thoracic cage, the ribs, the intercostal space, in order for us to locate the heart. So, surface anatomy is critical for the development of clinical skills competency. This is because the ability of surface anatomy to connect between the factual knowledge, such as the anatomy of the radial artery and the clinical practices such as the examination of distal pulses. And this clinical skill competency is not limited to clinical examination. It is also important for interventional procedures and radiological interpretation. Therefore, surface anatomy is considered as one of the essential components in anatomy and medical education. And study have shown that insufficient surface anatomy education has resulted in inaccurate clinical examination and unsafe clinical practices. Okay, now with the second part of my presentation. Here, I will share a story about the history of the surface anatomy education. And I believe this story is important in order for us to understand the issue surrounding the surface anatomy, and then maybe we can understand why we need the strategies to rectify the problem. In early 20th centuries, medical course was taught in a not standard format. So, and during this time, there is a demand for surface anatomy classes. This gentleman here, his name is Thomas Gilman Mohead, has conducted formal lecture and private classes in a college in Dublin. And on top of that, because of a high demand for surface anatomy knowledge, he also published a textbook due to the demand, not only from the learners, but also from the educators. And then in 1910, Flexner report was published in US in order to, in an attempt to standardize the medical education. However, due to this Flexner report, the medical curricula around the world has become segregated into two compartments, namely the preclinical and clinical phases. And because of that, the anatomy course has become long and prominent. However, many details in the anatomy were irrelevant to the clinical practice. And they are following that, there are two shortcomings noticed, especially among the clinical year medical students. And the problems are, they have poor basic science knowledge, and also they cannot apply the basic science concept in clinical situation. Following that, due to that, at the end of 20th century, General Medical Council has recommended a system-based and problem-based education. And because of that, medical curricula in UK and around most part of the world has been transformed from traditional discipline-based approach to a more integrated approach. The transformation of medical education also affects the surface anatomy education. There are few adaptations occur in surface anatomy teaching. In 1930, living models was started to be used in surface anatomy instruction as a complement to cadaver-based pedagogy. And started from 1970s till the current centuries, clinical input was integrated in the teaching and learning of surface anatomy because of the recommendation by GMC. And what happened in the current centuries? Further modification of anatomy teaching is occurred due to the advanced technology with innovative teaching strategies such as multimedia imaging, 3D painting, peer physical examination, and virtual anatomy. Although it looks good, but there are few issues in case of surface anatomy education for the current centuries. Due to the modern medical curriculum, there is a dramatic decline in the anatomy teaching hours and resources allocated to the surface anatomy. And on top of that, studies also showed that one of the effective methods to teach surface anatomy is by using multimodal teaching. Therefore, the challenge for anatomy educators in the current centuries is that to provide an effective teaching method for surface anatomy within the constraint of limited teaching hours and resources. Because of that, I and my team decided that we need to discover the effective strategies in surface anatomy teaching. So now let's go to the last part of my presentation. I have started the scoping review study last 3 years, and this review is meant to systematically map the available evidences in the current centuries. And from the extent of the evidences, we conduct a thematic analysis. And from the thematic analysis, we construct a new knowledge on the overview of effective strategies in surface anatomy teaching. This is the flowchart of our study. At the end, we select 26 studies that was conducted in various parts of the world. Okay, this table shows the 26 selected studies. Most of the study was published within the last 10 years, and the studies was conducted in various parts of the world, which come from 6 continentals, which is Europe, Asia, Australia, Americas, and Africa. Okay, these are the list of surface anatomy pedagogy with positive outcome. In concordance with previous studies, my study also found that multi-modal approaches is the most prevalent pedagogy and were proven to have positive outcome. Okay, and on top of that, we also found that most study of surface anatomy using the living human anatomy as the medium for hands-on session. So, what are the effective strategy in surface anatomy education? There are 4 main strategies in surface anatomy teaching and learning, and it can be easily remembered by using this abbreviation CAFE or CAFE. Okay, and C stands for contextualized teaching, A stands for learning, F stands for learning facilitation, and finally E stands for embrace experiential learning. In order to make us understand with these 4 strategies, it is equipped with 9 elements. For the first strategies, the element is authentic contextualization and clinical problem oriented. And then for active learning, it need to have element of interactive environment and active learning. For learning facilitation, the important element is teachers' roles and technology-enhanced teaching. And finally, to embrace into experiential learning, students need to conduct hands-on activity, students need to reflect, and students need to conceptualize. Okay, now I will explain or elaborate in detail about the each strategies with its element. Okay, the first strategy is contextualized teaching. The aim of contextualized teaching is actually to promote engagement among the learners. This can be done by using authentic contextualization. Authentic contextualization means that the teaching should include an element of clinical relevance. And the second element is clinical problem oriented. So the teaching should use problem-based method or clinical application or clinical case in order to bring context into the teaching. This strategy is actually supported by adult learning theory, whereby Cobbs in 1988 described that adult learners are more ready to learn when they realize the value, the career relevance, or the importance of the knowledge that they learn. And in surface anatomy, it is important for the learners to use their imagination capability. So by using a contextualized teaching, it will help the learners to engage into this imagination. Okay, next we go to the second strategy, which is the active learning. The aim of this active learning strategy is to promote participation among the learners. So for the first element, interactive environment, this can be provided by educators with the use of peer interaction strategy or feedback on performance. And on the other hand, active learning can be promoted with the use of collaborative learning and also small group setting. The example for active learning in surface anatomy teaching and learning is the use of peer-to-peer interaction or peer-to-peer examination. Peer-to-peer examination is useful because not only it can promote participation among learners, but it also can diffuse the formal learning environment. So with the diffuse formal learning environment, students will be easily accept the learning process. Okay, next we go to the third. Okay, next we go to the third strategy. The third strategy is learning facilitation, and of course the aim of this strategy is to facilitate the teaching and learning process. And in order to facilitate the teaching and learning process, teachers and technology can be used. The teachers can help by providing a systematic approach, adequate instruction, and flexible education to the teaching. And the technology enhanced teaching can be used in order to facilitate the learning process by the use of online platform, simulation, and clinical tools. This strategy is the potential solution for the issues related to the surface anatomy. This is because we can provide a multimodal approach in teaching and learning of surface anatomy. For example, like using a flipped classroom. But flipped classroom can also be used in a limited face-to-face time because we can use an online platform to cover the part that we cannot cover in the face-to-face session. So mainly with a proper planning from the teachers, we can divide the teaching session into online and face-to-face. Therefore, it is useful for anatomy education with constraints of limited time and resources. Okay, the last strategy is to embrace into experiential learning, and this is the most important strategy to increase the understanding of the learners. Experiential learning is also known as learn by doing, and in order to obtain meaningful experiential learning or to embrace into meaningful experiential learning, students need to do three things. One is to perform, second is to reflect, and third is to conceptualize. In order for students to perform, they need to conduct hands-on activity, and this can be provided with the use of living human, manicure, drawing, or clinical tools. And students can also need to reflect. Therefore, teacher need to allow students to reflect based on their performance, and on top of that, maybe to get some interactive feedback. And finally, the teaching should provide opportunity for students to think constructively and to conceptualize. Actually, how this experiential learning improve understanding is explained by Kolb's in his experiential learning theory. In this theory, there are four stages of the cycle, which is the concrete experience, reflective observation, abstract conceptualization, and active experimentation. So here, the educators should use should try to integrate the teaching and learning of surface anatomy into at any stage of this cycle, and then to facilitate the student to proceed to the next stages of this cycle. And also, educators can also use peer-to-peer learning to complete this COP expansion learning theory. And this is better because by using peer-to-peer concept, the learners can learn at their own pace and at their own time. Okay, and a little bit about, now, is it applicable in Malaysia? In Malaysia, we are using the outcome-based education, meaning that we design the course, you started from the learning outcome, and then we assess the outcome. Yes, as you can see here, the strategies is well fit in this outcome-based education. However, educators should know how to equip the surface anatomy teaching with these strategies based on the allocated learning outcome, time, ability, resources, and faculty support. Okay, although it is recommended to provide an innovative and ideal teaching, but it is a concern that it will require extra face-to-face teaching hours, additional workload for the anatomists, and complex interdepartmental collaboration. Therefore, I would recommend a wise adaptation of surface anatomy strategies to overcome the curriculum or institutional constraint. And what about the future direction? I do think that we should look forward to a scholarly teaching approach grounded with learning theories, and educators should also be an instructional designer and learning facilitator, and learners also should take part in the learning process with professional behaviors and adult learning skills. And therefore, as a take-home message, there was no single effective teaching method in surface anatomy. However, there were proven effective strategies to guide surface anatomy teaching, and multimodal approaches with adoption of these strategies is the key for effective teaching and learning in surface anatomy. With that, I finish my presentation, and thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasrul. Dr. Yasrul, we have one question from Dr. Nohida. Dr. Yasrul, how do you measure the effective learning in anatomy teaching in clinical years?
Sorry, can you speak
louder? Can you hear my voice?
Yeah, I can hear, but I cannot.
The question is, how do you measure the effective learning in anatomy teaching in clinical years?
Okay. Effective domain can be assessed using two ways. One is by observation, and second is by in an interactive OSP station. With the use of surface anatomy teaching, we can actually teach, or we can actually teach the effective part. For example, like the professional behavior, the communication skills among the learners, the interpersonal communication between different discipline. This can be teach in surface anatomy, and also can be assessed either using an interactive OSP station or OSCE, whereby the examiner can use a checklist to look at how the student perform in demonstrating the, for example, like the professional behaviors. And another way is maybe we can use the observation in the class as a one way to evaluate the effective part. I hope I answered the questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasrul, for the kind sharing and also answering the question from the participants. So we would like to thank you very much, Dr. Yasrul, for the kind accepting our invitation from UNIMAS as well from Russia. So probably Dr. Yasrul can help us later type your email address in the chat box for other participants who are very eager to know more on your topic, especially your PhD. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now we will proceed with our fourth plenary from Professor Dr. Yuri Vasilev. Okay, before I call Professor to share her fourth plenary, I will share his CV first. He's a professor at the Department of Clinical Anatomy at the Institute of Clinical Medicine at Astrakhan University, Moscow. I'm sorry if I wrongly pronounced. Involved in the training of graduate dentists in Russia, offering personal one-day courses, which include a lecture and a workshop. Scientific interest, Professor Dr. Yuri in a photonic oral medicine, clinical anatomy and education. He also author and co-author of more than 123 scientific articles, including 6 patents, 12 study books, and 2 workbooks for students. He is an active speaker at the FDI, EFAAD and conferences. So without further ado, I would like to call upon our professor, Dr. Yuri Vasilev, to share his plenary on anatomical and 3D technologies in anatomy, teaching and learning. Kindly welcome. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this nice presentation, and I very apologize for my background. I don't know, maybe the system works unpleasant, so you see the part of my room. And for this wonderful time, it is a really great opportunity to discuss the advantages and disadvantages of 3D learning and teaching in anatomy, because anatomy is something like our basin. From the anatomy we start, and in anatomy we finish, and we need to know which technologies and which methods which more suitable for teaching and learning, and for sure for the surviving. The COVID pandemic was a type of a hope, and the time when we got lots of complications with the anatomy learning and anatomy teaching. We know we got a great chance to update our vision of teaching, and we got the opportunity to increase the quality of the instruments we used, but we lost the possibilities of cadaver workshops, and we lost lots of points for the proper manual skills teaching. And what we should choose when we finish this strategy, and what should we use? I think it's a nice time to make a small feedback to the problem of teaching in general, because we all know that regular lectures and the workshops and seminars are very related to the teacher or to the professor. If you are a great speaker or if you are a great specialist in the field of knowledge, but you are very, very unpleasant speaker, students won't go to your lecture or your workshop. You may be a great specialist in surgery, but your patients won't listen to you because you can't explain in a proper way your vision and the results of your operations. And finally, we see that from some kind of 15% of those who attend the lectures, they do it physically. Mostly our students and our listeners and our colleagues, we are using the laptops and any electronic devices which helps us to join the conferences. And for me, I'm an example of this opportunity. I'm in Russia and the conference in Malaysia. But now we have a great amount of e-learning platforms, e-learning books and so on, and lots of our students are using these electronic books. Is it good? Is it a time to make a kind of mix between technology and tradition? Is it a time to go back to the dissection hall and use electronic and 3D devices to increase the theoretical knowledge and increase the quality of the manual skills? It is, but we need to know the golden standard, and we need to know where to stop. Are we really ready for a nice pedagogical practice? Are we really ready to include the collaborative technique in our teaching? Are we ready for the integration of our students inside the class? We know lots of examples when we are using the vertical type of teaching, when you are a headliner and students are only listening to you. But it is time to go below or maybe above to the horizontal type of learning and teaching. We are colleagues and we need to be in touch with the students, because some of our abilities are very, very poor in modern techniques, and we need to know which instruments can moderate the proper knowledge and which instruments are very suitable and user-friendly for our students. We for sure know that the tradition is great, but we need to understand that the modern technologies, they are so brilliant and they are so young that some of our colleagues, because of some problems maybe, or maybe some cases, they can't be in time and they can lose the last chance to increase the quality of the teaching. And I want to share my vision, how should we work in different parts of the educational process. We know that we have a pedagogic process when we have students which study in our universities, and we have postdoc, we have residentship, we have some scientific collaboration. And even if we speak with students, and even if we study and we'll teach and learn anatomy, first of all, for sure, we need to give a nice theory, how it be. It can be electronic, it can be real, it's up to you. Then for sure, you need to make a kind of the control, because our students, they're very simple users of our anatomy teaching and learning. Then when they have enough knowledge and when you control the quality of this knowledge, you can insert your students to the VR or AR world. Because in this cyber reality, we have no opportunity to damage the cadavers or simulators. You have lots of tries. You can retry in many, many conditions, and you can use these devices in any situations you're performing in the class. But after that, when you perform the control, you need to think, is the student okay for real life in the anatomy teaching? Is it okay to allow him to take a scalpel and make a preparation of the cadaver? So we have additional step before we allow our students to enter to the golden standard of anatomy teaching. But let's look in the other hand to the andragogy, we call it, for those who are not a students in the classical presentation vision, but those who are postdoc, those who are residents and so on. For them, they have a real clinical practice already. They are well prepared in theoretical way. So we can give them directly the VR or ER technology. For sure, we can allow them to use the cadaver material, and only after we can make a kind of a control. It's up to you. You can make one more step and use once again the ER and VR technology. But if you use the cadaver material for those who attend your class, you can already understand, even if their manual knowledge or maybe they have a lack of theoretical knowledge and you need to increase using this or that step. Let's look how it was in 2020 and how it is in 2022. We can find the nice presentation of morphology scientific journal that virtual education for the 2020 was the only possibility for teaching because of the pandemic and so on. But now we need to survive, and we need to say that the anatomy teaching and learning is the combination of electronic, VR, ER, various integrated technologies, and for sure, the real methods of teaching, because we need to make a proper adaptation. We can't make a cyber doctor. We can't perform a 3D doctor for the 3D patients. It's kind of maybe of telemedicine, but for real patients, it can be a little bit complicated. We need to give the proper feeling of the instrument in the hand, but not the devices for the VR preparation. And let's look for the question of the anxiety in case of education in the remote access. We can see that from 1994 till 2022, we have lots of researches and scientific papers which shows a great results of these researches. And we decided to make a small research about the levels of anxieties in students who studied in a big city and in a small city. And we performed this research with the Saratov and Samara State Medical Universities. And you see that the goal was to find, even if the anxiety was extremely high, or maybe it was more or less moderate or average. And we see that in most of cases, when we speak about e-learning and remote access to the anatomy classes, we see the moderate degree of the anxiety. Finally, only a very small amount of persons got the high level of the anxiety, and maybe it was the result of the pandemic, and finally the result of the sitting in a small house without integration to the real classes. Anyhow, when we plan our classes, we need to think, even if the students are in the anxiety or maybe they have some disorders which can't give the proper usage of the VR technologies. Once again, when we compare the VR anatomy education in years, we see that lots of cases and lots of scientific papers were printed in the last 5 years. And it's a nice opportunity, and it's nice when we hope that the cyber reality and VR reality will give us the proper knowledge, the proper maybe manual skill, but we never ever understand that we can be slaves of these technologies. In the cyber world, you do not control the reality. You have no controls for the proper feelings, and those who perform the program, they can moderate your vision, because only cadaver material give you the proper understanding of strongness and thickness of the tissues and strongness and the weight of the instrument. But let's go inside. We have in our department the laboratory for the VR technologies, and we have few simulators which teach the anatomy, and we performed our special simulator for the prolon processes treatment. I will say a little bit above for this, but we got the opportunity to use the 3D organon system. It's a VR app where you have a chance to rotate some part of the human body, and you have the titles, and you can go inside the cavities and the organs. But for the first vision, it was like a wow effect. But now I can say that the VR technology, it's an additional instrument which can be used only by one student. You need to use lots of devices, and you need to perform a great amount of devices in the class if you want to join it and if you want to teach in this system. But also we need to say that the quality of the image can be reduced at the computer and will can be increased in the VR technology. It depends also at the quality of the goggles which you use. So the technology is nice, but for some cases it can be extremely expensive. And once again, it should be very delicate how we say the technology works in one hand. It's not so nice to use for a great amount of the students, but also it's a nice possibility to show how the structures, muscles and organs are inside the body. For sure, if you have an individual teaching, it's nice and pleasant, but it's unpleasant when you are speaking about the class of the students. And for sure, the VR is a technology we should focus at the healthy body. If you have some disorders which is associated with your vestibular system, or maybe you have some problems with your eyes and many, many others, maybe you are frightened about the cyberspace where you are included. All of these aspects should be discussed before you integrate your students inside the virtual reality. There are lots of advantages, and there are some disadvantages which I think it is important to share. First of all, advantages which we see in the VR, there are no danger if we speak about proper use. If you explain how to use this or that situation or this or that simulator, it's fine. But if you do not explain how to behave in this cyber room, it will be dangerous for your student. Also, VR technology gives us the uncountable amount of the chances. When we work, for example, with surgery, you can try again, again, and again. You can imagine and you can perform any aspects. You can replace the instruments and so on. In any ways, you can train your students. And it's a nice possibility. Once again, I think it's a part of education, but it shouldn't be at the top. But this is the advantages. And what are the disadvantages of virtual reality or VR technology? First of all, it is nice when you use it in single mode, you're a student, it's okay. But if you have a class, if you are asking for the feedback, and even if the program or the app do not have this ability for those who are inside, it will be difficult to communicate with the students which are in touch with the cyber body. You will be like, you will only assist them, but you won't have the ability to communicate and to control what they are doing. Also, the obsession. The Land Mower Man, the movie, it was very nice many years ago, and it shows us we should be in worries about the mental health of those who are in the virtual technology. It is very easy to find some fantasy world inside and to think that you are creator, but only you need to remember always that you are a user. You are a user inside the system, and those who create the world, they give the direct scenario for this work and education. If you think that you need to add something pleasant and interesting to the cyber body, like let's imagine that we have the agonon axis and we think that the muscle looks unpleasant, we can't change it and we can't replace it. The system already works according to the direct program, how it was performed. And finally, it is unreal. It is really unreal for those who understand how the body should look, for those who are in touch with the real anatomy. And it is a very high risk to teach that the body, the structures and the colors should be how it is presented in this nice atlas. So it's a part of the technology. It should be used very, very, you should be patient when you use this VR reality in your proper work. It shouldn't be an access for the unpleasant vision. Oops, I'm very sorry, but the slide is not performing the direct information, but I will explain in words. So we performed the survey for the specialists in medicine. Even if they are interested in the anatomical devices like anatomical table, I think most of you knows these technologies, and it's a great chance to see that more than 80% of the specialists of the general medicine and more than 35% on those who are in maxillofacial, general dentistry, maxillofacial surgeons, more than 75% of those who are interested in these technologies, because it's a nice opportunity to, if you are in the body or you are making some manual, you can easily go to the anatomical table. You can look how it's better to go inside, and then you can plan your proper operation. As for the VR technology, a little bit feedback to the previous part of the report. This is a VR simulator which was performed in our department, so with the help of VR laboratory of the section of university. We decided that it is nice to train our students and postdocs how to treat the purulent processes at the face. And we know that it is very complicated, even if we use cadavers, because especially at the face, it is very thin tissues. It's very it should be very well qualified surgery if we work with the nerves and so on. And even if the students cut them, we have no chance to survive because our material is already dead. So the cadaver is only after this VR technology. We have the cyber room, we have a head with the various clinical cases. You see a nice, very nice anatomy behind the skin. And our student has the task to choose the proper instrument, to choose the proper landmark for the access inside the face, and then they should make this incision and explore, even if they okay, or maybe they made some kind of the mistakes. And the system, we have two possibilities. We can teach and we can control some kind of the exam. And it's a nice way to train students before they go to the cadaver workshop. Advantages of the virtual simulators for surgery. We do not speak about anatomy. It's because in anatomy, VR is not so nice. But for the surgery, it's once again the opportunity to train. Some of my colleagues, I have the feedback. They told me that, you know, I'm afraid to make a mistake. The virtual simulator gives you the chance to make this mistake, to understand what you perform in the wrong way, to understand which tissues and which structures can be damaged if you go in this way. If you use another instrument, what will happen, and so on. And after that, the system gives you the feedback. It explains you which mistakes were performed and how it can decrease the quality of the operation. And we can compare the vision in the previous very nice scientific articles. I especially founded them because in 2017 and also in 2018, you see that researchers had a suggestion for various methods of the anatomy, especially gross anatomy teaching. For sure, students are in touch with the technology. They feel some interest for this, but they need to compare. They need to compare this wonderful picture in the VR class with the real one. They should remember how all the organs and tissues looks and how we feel the strongness of these tissues. And once again, we go back to the anatomical table, and my respected colleague Dr. Aikush from Samara, she will make a nice report, I know, about this technology which was performed in Russia. But I will share my opinion how we can use the anatomical table. We can use it in various comparisons. For example, you include your MRI or UCT and so on into the program, and you explore the pathological process, but you forgot, for example, in some cases, that what is this at the MRI? You can go to the normal anatomy, you can disclude layers, and you can find okay, this is maybe a variation of normal anatomy, or if you compare the 3D normal in this anatomical Pirogov table with the MRI, you will have a chance to give your patients a new chance for surviving, maybe, or maybe you will plan your operation in another way. This is the one step. In another way, we need to say that the cadavers has some disadvantages in using. We know that the numbers of the manipulations are limited. We know that we need to save the corpse in a proper way, and in sometimes we need to use a very toxic materials. But when we use these materials, the quality of the tissues and colors of the tissues can be reduced. That's why we need to make a mix. We need to use the electronic devices with the interactive anatomical tables. Maybe we can print, and we got small experience in the 3D printing. We got a 3D printer, and we performed a normal organs, and also we performed a part of the pathological process which was included to the normal anatomy. And it was a nice training for neurosurgeons to, they trained how to make a proper access. But in general, let me say that it is a nice technology, and if your 3D printer is great, you can perform a very nice simulator of the organ. But if you have a lack of materials, or maybe if your material which you use for printing is not so pleasant, the result won't be very successful in use. And when we speak about the combination of the devices, for me, once again, it is nice when you have a possibility to use a 3D in VR, but you need to be sure that the picture is very greatly performed. You need to know that the structures are really exist. In some anatomical atlases and in some anatomical tables, we can find that they use for reconstruction the MRI or CT X-rays researches. And it is not a really normal anatomy. It's a types, and it's a variation of normal anatomy. But when we teach, we should everywhere, we should use the same anatomy for the normal anatomy, I think. For clinical, okay, it's nice to use variations, but the idea of the table is I make a preparation, how you see at the picture. I train, for example, in this or that manual technology, but also if I'm wondering about this or that structure which is below my incitation point, or I don't know, maybe my preparation was unpleasant and I cut the blood vessel or nerve, I can go directly to the anatomical table and I can compare. I can rotate the anatomical preparation, or I can rotate it in the keyboard space. It's up to the user, but it is a nice opportunity to combine the anatomical preparation and the anatomical table. And I apologize for the Russian in this survey. I forgot, I'm very sorry, I forgot to translate, but I will translate it to you. We ask our students about their vision. Is it useful, and is it necessary to use the cadaver material for the anatomy teaching? And you see, no. Only 20% of those who answered in this survey said that they do not need the cadaver material. And more than 79% of those who answered at this survey, they said, yes, they need a cadaver material for their proper learning. That's why it's a nice way for combination. And when we see the results of the years which were before pandemic, which was during pandemic, and now we are people of post-pandemic period, we need to take all the best we got in the past. We know that it is nice to make a dissection in the classes, but also we need to use the technologies we can use for individuals, VRs or AR technology. The AR technology is the very pleasant technology for surgery and for the postdoc education. And in our case, it's a nice method to combine the anatomical tables maybe with the cadavers and VRs and with the CT and MRI viewers. So in my vision, the anatomy learning and teaching is a kind of a life. Our anatomy is a very modern, our anatomy subject is a very is a very technological process, as the human body is. So we need to combine the methods which we use for clinic, and even if we see the result of the communication with the students and staff, we can combine these methods with our teaching and learning. So I tried to share with you the devices which we use in our department, and I tried to share the vision, how I see the proper anatomy teaching. And finally, my decision is that it is nice to use 3D and VR, but we shouldn't forget about the cadaver dissection, and we shouldn't forget the instruments, we shouldn't forget the abilities of use of human body, because we treat real patients. We do not treat cyber patients. We do not treat 3D models. Our patients are applying for life, and only life can give the opportunity for the proper education. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Prof. Yuri Vasilev, for the kind sharing session. So probably
So I finished. I apologize, maybe it was a little bit shorter than it was planned, but
It's okay, Prof, no problem. So I believe that Prof shared just now the statistics, how the students' interest on the anatomy teaching and learning. So I think we also can learn something from the Russia, since in UNIMAS also we ever attend the webinar or CME or we call CPD for the sharing session from their anatomical teaching and learning method to improvise to improve the our anatomy classes for our UNIMAS. Thank you, Professor, for your kind sharing.
Thank you.
I open to all participants. If you have any question, you can unmute your mic and directly ask Professor Yuri, or you also can type in the chat box. Later, we can read for you and ask Professor Yuri. Meanwhile, waiting for any question from the participants, later maybe Prof. Yuri will share your email address in case we have a participant who would like to have any question, so we can have your email address in the chat box so other participants can directly email to you, Prof. Is it okay? Thank you very much, Prof. Okay. For participants, we already shared the attendance and feedback link in the chat box. So you participants need to click the link and also fill up the Google form, and then you submit at the end of the completing the form. Okay. Thank you very much, Prof. Yuri, for your kind sharing session and join us. So hopefully we can have another session with you, Prof. In the future. Collaboration between UNIMAS and Russia. Thank you. Okay. Before we proceed with our fifth plenary, our last session for today, I would like to read the CV from our speaker. Hopefully, the last plenary for today. Okay, I will read first the CV from our speaker. Our last speaker for today, Professor Dr. Sergei Porosky. He is a Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs and also Head of the Department for Emergency and Disaster Medicine at Volgograd State Medical University, Volgograd, Russia. He obtained his medical doctor in 2000 from Volgograd State Medical University and PhD in Medicine. Doctor of Medical Sciences 2012. Professor research areas are research of healing, mechanism and methods of tissue regeneration, design and application of new bioactive materials in surgery, research of pathogenesis, morphology and prevention methods of post-operative adhesions in the abdominal cavity, research of the endothelial dysfunction, the pathogenesis of surgical diseases, medical, he also is a medical and organizational issue of safety in emergency situation, optimization of the organization of medical care in emergency situation using digital technology. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Professor Dr. Sergey Porosky to share his fifth plenary for today, entitled Personification of Undergraduate Medical Education of the Volgograd State Medical University. Kindly welcome, Prof. Thank you. Prof. Sugi, can you hear my voice. Sorry for the technical problem. We will inform get once Prof. Sergey rejoin us, but just now he joined already. We'll wait for him to rejoin again. Thank you. Waiting for Prof. Sergey, I would like to share the QR code attendance for UNIMAS staff while waiting. Okay. For UNIMAS staff, you can scan the QR code for attendance for today.
Dear colleagues, I would like to welcome all the participants of this event today, all the organizers, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. Today in my speech, I would like to demonstrate the experience of Volgograd State Medical University in implementing the personalized model of the educational process, which has ultimately led to the fact that we at the university have also restructured the educational programs in which we have introduced components just related to the implementation of the presented model, which I would like to tell you about.
Как раз связанные с реализацией представленной и модели, о которой я хотел бы вам сейчас рассказать.
Since 2013, the term continuous medical education has been actively used and introduced in Russia, which is a system of education that ensures continuous improvement of professional knowledge and skills throughout life, as well as the continuous development and expansion of professional competences in the formation of a doctor and his or her further professional growth.
И расширение профессиональных компетенций при формировании врача и при его дальнейшем профессиональном развитии. В общем-то, и та модель...
This model of continuous medical education is presented before your eyes. It includes the system of training in medical school with a transition to the system of postgraduate training in residency, then postgraduate studies, and subsequently...
Sorry, Prof. Do you have access to your mic already?
И модель, которую я хочу представить.
Уважаемые коллеги.
Dear colleagues, I would like to welcome all the participants of this event today, all the organizers, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. Today in my speech, I would like to demonstrate the experience of Volgograd State Medical University in implementing the personalized model of the educational process, which has ultimately led to the fact that we at the university have also restructured the educational programs in which we have introduced components just related to the implementation of the presented model, which I would like to tell you about.
Как раз связанные с реализацией представленной и модели, о которой я хотел бы вам сейчас рассказать.
Since 2013, the term continuous medical education has been actively used and introduced in Russia, which is a system of education that ensures continuous improvement of professional knowledge and skills throughout life, as well as the continuous development and expansion of professional competences in the formation of a doctor and his or her professional growth.
This
model of continuous medical education is presented before your eyes. It includes the system of training in medical school with a transition to the system of postgraduate training in residency, then postgraduate studies. And subsequently, throughout the doctor's life, the physician studies in the system of postgraduate training, in advanced training, in professional retraining, and in the system of certified professional educational activities.
Профессиональных образовательных мероприятий. Однако, если мы задумаемся...
However, if we think about it, ask the question, is everything taken into account the effects a given system in the classical components or in the classical representation of continuous medical education? The answer to this question is the reason why we have started to actively reconsider the personalized study system.
Мы начали активно рассматривать модель системы персонифицированного обучения. Первый вопрос, который...
The first question must be asked is, who is coming to university? How much do our studying and its quality depend on who comes to us, whom we get to us as applicants for further studies?
Кого мы получаем в качестве абитуриентов для последующего обучения? И, наконец-то, вопрос...
And the final question, what is the system of passing on experience in the future? How is it carried out? And this model, which will be presented to you, is born out of the solutions and the answers to the questions posed.
собственно, и родилась из решения и ответов на поставленные вопросы. Первый.
The first is the system of pre-university training and career guidance, and this system undoubtedly plays a significant role in the formation of future specialists who come to university to study medical specialties. And finally, how this knowledge, these skills are shared. It is the mentoring system which is not in the final scheme. He have presented. It is an integral part of the whole system that shapes studying throughout both the undergraduate and postgraduate phases of a doctor's training.
Системы, которая формирует обучение на протяжении и до дипломного этапа, и после дипломного этапа обучения врача. С нашей точки зрения, именно вся
From our point of view, it is this network that is the whole system of continuous medical education from the people who go to university to the system of postgraduate training for the specialist that will follow him throughout his professional life.
Который будет преследовать его на протяжении всей профессиональной жизни. Итак, хотелось бы немножечко представить
So, I would like to briefly introduce the components that we have just mentioned. The first is the system of pre-university training and career guidance. Let's first of all ask the question of the applicants, that is, on the part of those applicants who come to us.
Кто приходит? То есть это со стороны тех абитуриентов, которые приходят к нам. Что они хотят?
What do they want from the university? One, I want to be a doctor. Second, I'm ready for the higher education system. Medical school is a conscious choice of the student. I'm ready to go to the medical school. I'm not trying to go. I'm ready to go to the medical school.
И я готов к поступлению в медицинский вуз. Я не пытаюсь поступить, а готов к поступлению в вуз. И наконец-то развернемся с другой стороны.
And finally, let's look at it from a different perspective. What do we want from this applicant on the part of the university? What are our views on this applicant? It is naturally the selection of the best applicant. It is a reduction in the number of dropouts, which will undoubtedly occur in the first 2 years of study as much as possible.
Повышение качества подготовки выпускника.
It is an increase in the quality of graduate training. These issues on the part of both applicants and universities ensure the need for a system of pre-university training.
Вузовской подготовки. Когда-то мы проводили
We once conducted a research and posed a question to the first year students who had already been admitted. When did you decide on your future profession of medicine? And the majority of the students answered us as follows. Their choice was formed when they were still studying in secondary school, grades 5 to 9, and in high school, grades 10 to 11. And a fairly large number of first-year students responded that they had always wanted to be a doctor.
И в старшей школе, 10-11 класс. И достаточно большое количество уже первокурсников ответили, что профессия медиком они хотели стать всегда. Большая часть как раз
Most of them are representatives of whole medical generations. They grew up in the medical sphere.
То есть, которые, в принципе, росли в медицинской сфере.
This scheme allowed us to identify those age periods that are worth paying special attention to in order to start career guidance work.
Для начала профориентационной работы. Этими периодами
We have distinguished two main periods.
Нами двух основных периодов. Это ранняя медико-биологическая профориентация школы, школьников, когда мы начали заниматься с четвертыми, девятыми классами.
Early biomedical career guidance for school children. When we started working with the fourth and ninth grades, we set up a school for medics at the university, which also does project work. And classes with school children in the 10th to 11th grades are focused on early medical career guidance for school leavers. For this purpose, a structural subdivision was created, which is called VSMU Pre-University, and the systems of biomedical classes were implemented in it. If we look in detail at the tasks which are solved in each of these areas, in 4th to 9th classes, where we spoke about early biomedical career guidance of schoolboys, the first task is to create interest and talented school children in order to involve them in a system of a medical biological profile.
Для того, чтобы их вовлечь в систему медико-биологического профиля. Это профориентация через науку.
This is career guidance through our science, our project work, expanding their biomedical horizons.
Это
It is training them in public speaking skills and forming a group of future students of medical pre-university classes of Volgograd State Medical University. The School for Young Medics, founded in 1997, trains around 200 school children in grades 4 to 9 every year. The Volgograd State Medical University pre-university school is attended by students in grades 10 to 11, which means that they are all graduates. I would like to emphasize once again that the main task here is not biomedical, but medical professional orientation of school graduates. The task becomes the professional selection of school leavers and the shaping of their professional routes. It is here, in the pre-university school, that the system of continuing medical education we're talking about begins. In the in-depth study of specialized subjects, adaptation to the more mode of higher education, the provision of the best material and technical conditions for the professional development of the student in the medical field, which schools cannot provide, are no less important. It is the immersion into the university environment, academic, scientific, extracurricular. Furthermore, creating an educational environment of like-minded people, which fosters a desire in the student to come for further education. I would like to show some statistics. The number of students studying in biomedical classes in pre-university has risen from 5 to 316 in 4 years.
Обучающихся в медико-биологических классах кратно увеличилось с 5 до 316 человек.
Currently, the pre-university implements personalized education for each of the students according to their own needs, their own educational paths, both in full-time and part-time base.
Образовательных как в очном, так и в очно-заочных форматах.
Today, Volgograd State Medical University has 17 partner schools in Volgograd and Volgograd region. In order to fulfill the described tasks of Volgograd State Medical University pre-university and to form not only a career-oriented applicant, but also one prepared for school, specialized authoring programs were created, which deal with both medical disciplines and natural science and adaptational disciplines. I would like to point out that one of the most important disciplines that we have created and that we give to children is the basics of medical terminology and speech. This is where children begin to speak for the first time and they're taught how to speak correctly. The fact is that it is the fear of speaking, the inability to speak correctly, that it constitutes one of the barriers in their transition to the first year and the beginning of their studies in higher education. A seemingly elementary practice in front of you is the issuing of the so-called certificates for pupils of biomedical classes. But this is a ritual, a kind of initiation into the pre-university. Children who receive these certificates, they already identify themselves with Volgograd State Medical University, becoming a
part of it. К части Волгоградского государственного медицинского университета формируется причастность к нему.
They participate in student creative clubs and groups, fully integrating themselves into the student community. But besides these opportunities, this certificate allows access to the reading rooms of the library for school students, to electronic libraries, to all resources of the library system of Volgograd State Medical University, access to electronic information of educational environment of Volgograd State Medical University. And it is a kind of pass to all academic buildings of VSMU, because it is in them, in the laboratories, where the main training of school children takes place. Our own electronic resource was created, and it has played a huge role when we talk about the pandemic. The children did not stop learning in our laboratories as they continued to be in contact online. The electronic environment made it possible to communicate not only with the children but also with the teachers. And we carry out with them in a single conglomerate the education and training of future VSMU applicants.
Целом обучение, систему обучения и подготовки будущих абитуриентов Волгоградского медицинского университета.
Pre-university students study in the laboratories of VSMU. All the material and technical base is available to them. They have access to the latest simulation centers where they consolidate their first aid skills and get acquainted with the future material and technical possibilities of training at VSMU.
Возможностями обучения в Волгоградском государственном медуниверситете. Кроме того, их траектория обучения.
In addition, their training trajectory is directly related to healthcare organizations. They go into healthcare facilities and are taught by nursing staff, doctors and emergency medical practitioners. They enjoy visiting them and are already following their medical preferences.
Посещают их и уже формируют свои предпочтения медицинские.
Some of them leave at the stage of first visits to the medical institutions, but it is probably for the better than if we're talking about a wrong career choice when they're already students. I draw attention to the fact that pupils are fully integrated into the student environment. This creates additional connections and opportunities. And their learning trajectory is tied not only to the knowledge of project activities, but also to new friends and new contacts already made in the student community. Former pre-university graduates become mentors, and today we're talking about a mentoring system for biomedical students. And this bridge, the connection between the school pupil, the future student, and the current students is very important in the path of initial training trajectory.
Является очень важным в пути их траектории обучения, начальной пути траектории их обучения.
Today, VSMU students have created a separate system of clubwork called Dialogue as Equals. These are former pre-university students who implement a self-study system. The seniors meet with the juniors where they try to talk to them independently about the most difficult points that arise in their studies.
Рассказывать одни из самых сложных моментов, которые вопросов, которые вызывают в процессе их обучения.
And the mentoring system is paying off. The pre-university system does not only work at university level, it has gone beyond it. Students take part in various competition programs. The most important achievement is that the Volgograd State Medical University Pre-University Center has entered into cooperation with a large regional center for work with talented children, Green Wave, which is a reservoir of talents with whom we are beginning to work and attract to the medical and biological profile.
С которыми мы начинаем работать и привлекать к медико-биологическому профилю. Естественно,
naturally, all project activities are reflected in the numerous conferences and conference outcomes that our children deserve. I would like to draw attention to another area. For the first time since 2020, the best students of the pre-university are assigned to large medical organizations and come to us as target students for places commissioned by medical organizations themselves.
Заказчиками которого являются, собственно, медицинские организации. Если мы говорим о результатах,
if we talk about the results of this pre-university trajectory, you see the smallest number of the first graduates in 19, when 20% were admitted to VSMU. Everyone else went to other universities. But the most important thing is that all of them entered universities of medical and biological profile.
Но самое главное, что все они поступали в вузы медико-биологического профиля.
Today, Volgograd State Medical University admitted 60% of all students. And this is according to the data of 2020. As a result of this system, in the 21st year of VSMU created for the first time a separate structural subdivision, the Center of Pre-University Education. Pre-University VSMU, which united the entire system of work at the pre-diploma level. This includes biomedical classes, a preparatory department, and the School of Young Medics. After the primary selection took place, we received applicants, they enter the VSMU student community, and studies begin. What are the requirements here? On the part of the students, the requests are as follows. It is very interesting for me to study. I get more modern knowledge. I am provided with conditions for obtaining practical skills. When I finish my studies, I know what specialty I will choose. And I would like to emphasize this. By completing my studies, I know which specialty I will choose. This is a very important second stage of career guidance, but it is already a professional orientation aimed at ensuring that each graduate already understands his or her future study. The questions they ask and the preferences that are presented are not just preferences, they are conducted survey. What do we see at this stage and what have we done to form a personalized study path? Firstly, we have a curricula and federal standards that sufficiently formalize the education system. There are certain requirements for the formation of educational programs. At the same time, they allow us to create a component that will ensure sufficient flexibility in the curriculum that we're talking about.
Создать компонент, который обеспечит достаточную гибкость учебного плана.
Practical orientation of the curriculum, formation of individual trajectories, continuity of study, and consideration of students' professional preferences. And undoubtedly, a huge role in the education system is played by the system of extracurricular work, which is built through a whole system of departmental circles, workshops, student creative clubs, schools of excellence, which take place on a regular basis. The task of trajectories is to form additional in-depth professional knowledge, skills, formation of professional preferences, and a set of certain competences that are additional to the competences that are formed in the process of classroom
work.
In addition, this system implements individualization of education through the conscious choice of one's trajectory. I would like to point out how this is achieved. In the first and second year, the system which implements an individual learning model, personalized learning, is aimed at reinforcing the conviction in the right choice of specialty, in the formation of fundamental knowledge. For this purpose, we have introduced practice-oriented disciplines such as research organization, first aid, general nursing, and general surgical care into the curriculum in the first and second years. The third and fourth years change their objectives. The main objective is to form primary professional preferences and to ensure the integration of fundamental and clinical knowledge. For this purpose, through the system of elective classes, through additional disciplines, individual trajectories of each student are formed, who gradually choose their own study.
Который выбирает свои, постепенно выбирает свою траекторию обучения. И, наконец-то, максимальное количество.
Maximum number of elective courses is in the fifth and sixth year, respectively. Here, the main task is to form a professional choice. So, every graduate should ideally complete studies with an understanding of the future professional pathway.
То, о чем мы говорили, когда шла речь о том, что каждый выпускник должен завершать обучение, понимая свою дальнейшую профессиональную траекторию. В итоге в Волгоградском медуниверситете
сформировалась своя система обучения каждого студента, которая разделена на два трека. The first track is a student who's studying and passing through the system of personalized learning enters a medical organization with a preference for working in the healthcare system, providing medical healthcare,
работы в системе здравоохранения, оказания медицинской помощи. И второе направление – это аналогичные компетенции, но ориентированные больше на научные деятельности и выходом в специальности аспирантуры. И одним из направлений
And one of the directions of professional trajectory of movement of the students is occupation of open places in the faculties of VSMU.
В среде преподавательского состава Волгоградского медуниверситета. Ну и наконец-то система внеучебной работы.
Finally, the system of extracurricular activities. How important is it? We have placed a huge emphasis on extracurricular activities. Through the system of this work, students participate in shaping their individual trajectory, supplementing and contributing to the formation of professional self-determination, providing additional professional skills and ensuring in-depth study of the specialty.
Обеспечивает углубленное изучение специальности и эта система
And this system makes it possible to move away from the strict framework of the curriculum and ensure the freedom of choice.
В результате эта система
As a result, this system is now being actively developed and a system of extracurricular departmental work is being developed as well. In front of you are presented just a number of large schools of skills clubs which work in different departments and deal with students in extracurricular time using all material technical resources of VSMU.
Материально-технического ресурса и базы Волгоградского государственного медицинского университета.
Certainly, the meeting point of classroom and extracurricular work is the largest center which opened in 2020 at the university. This is 3,000 square meters of simulation classrooms, where both the classroom training of graduates and the postgraduate training system for doctors take place, and extracurricular work, where clubs, in particular the surgery club,
Thank you very much, Prof. For a kind sharing session for our fifth plenary. So I would like to open for all the participants. If you have any question to Prof. Segi, you can unmute your mic and ask the question directly to Prof. If you have any difficulty to unmute your mic, you can also type in the chat box. I can read the question to Prof. Segi. Thank you. Prof. Segi, you can. Prof. Segi, can you hear my voice?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. So probably, I would like to ask Prof. regarding the. The challenges what we are facing during the pandemic COVID-19 in your medical school, probably in terms of the learning as well as the assessment. Probably Prof. Segi can brief us regarding that. Thank you.
Задает вопрос про вызовы пандемии для обучения. Что наш опыт? Как что? Вы говорите на русском, я вас буду.
Для решения вопросов образовательных в момент пандемии у нас была достаточно хорошо подготовленная система электронного обучения, которая позволила нам нивелировать вот, возможность очного присутствия студентов на занятиях.
Thank you so much for your question. So during the pandemic, surely we had challenges, but nevertheless, even before pandemic, we had a very good and stable electronic system for the education, and we have already created a good electronic platform. So our students, we didn't lose any time and we could adapt easily and very fast to this electronic online distance education.
И второй момент, естественно, лечебные учреждения были переведены в режим приема пациентов, и, соответственно, клинические базы наши в этом отношении существенно уменьшились. Но в этот момент на помощь нам пришли те симуляционные центры, которые к этому моменту уже были созданы, и симуляционные центры приняли на себя основной поток студентов для практической подготовки.
Surely, the medical education asks for the practice, for a lot of practice at the hospitals. But during the pandemic, all the hospitals in Volgograd, as in whole Russia, they were changed for the taking patients with COVID, and it was red zone, so we could not teach our students at these hospitals. They could not practice with the people with COVID, so that's why we have created this e-medical center, and we have this simulation centers, which saved us and helped us to teach students like at the hospitals.
И третий момент, мы перестроили учебные планы, которые позволили нам перенести клиническую часть занятий на период сегодняшнего дня, когда ребята фактически наверстывают те моменты в лечебных учреждениях, которые были не упущены, а которые были отданы на симуляционное обучение, и сейчас они их отрабатывают в клинике.
And also we have changed a little bit the curriculum of the medical students, so we have postponed a real clinical practice at real hospitals for a little bit later time, and this is happening right now. Right now all the students, they practice 3 times more, and they work extra for those lost time during the pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof, for your kind sharing. I believe even in UNIMAS also we have difficulty during the 2 years examination, especially the clinical years. So hopefully by having this symposium, we can exchange later more information. Especially for the medical education. Thank you again, Prof, for your kind accepting our invitation and your kind sharing during this symposium. I wish that you and your team in medical school in Volgograd has a very pleasant day today, and hopefully can meet again and collaborate in future. Thank you very much. So. I would like to say thank you very much to all the speakers and all participants for having this day one. If you notice, right, we've almost at the end of a day one symposium, Anatomical and Allied Health Sciences Symposium 2022. So before we ending our session for today, just for remind for tomorrow, we will begin with the same link, Webex link, same time, around 1:15 to 1:30 o'clock Malaysian time. And then we will also share the e-certificate for all participants who joining us via email. And then for those that also ask, right, the recorded version, we also share the YouTube link. And then we also will share in the link for both days in your email. Okay, on behalf of the organizer, I'm Dr. Shazrina. I would say thank you very much for all your kind participation, engagement. Even though it's very virtual, right? We don't see face to face, but however, I believe the spirit to learn from Russia and Malaysia, that we can feel the enthusiasm from all both participants, Malaysia and Russia. So I would say apologize for any technical issue from my side as a moderator, and for all speakers, thank you very much for your kind sharing, and all participants, thank you, and hopefully to see you again tomorrow. Thank you very much, and to all my Muslim colleagues, friends, doctors, for Malaysia, happy breakfast. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow. Mm.